This podcast is brought to you by patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Head there to check out exclusive podcasts like Talking Futurama, Talking of the Hill, the What a Cartoon Movie podcast, and tons more.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy, hoy, everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, the podcast that burns like a Glasgow bikini wax. I'm your host, the man with two knives, Bob Mackey, and this is our chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who is here with me today, as always?
Hey, it's Henry Gilbert, and I've never had a term in the Oval Office.
And who do we have on the line?
Chris Negotiabot Cabin.
And this week's episode is Brawl in the Family.
Oh, we'll see about that. One, two, three, go!
This week's episode originally aired on January 6, 2002, and as always, Henry will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real world history.
Oh boy, Bobby, Nickelback's How You Remind Me is number one on the charts. Disney re-releases Beauty and the Beast in IMAX format, and a light aircraft crashes in Tampa Bay, Florida that scares everyone, but it was just an accident.
Just a drunk.
Yes. It was one of several times of like, is this 9/11 again? Is this it? And it never was.
I knew they would come for my golf course.
Everybody was sure that 9/11 was coming for them at every second. Yeah, but
you never knew. It was every once a week. We had 3 months of peace, and any moment it could just come back.
but instead, it was us doing the 9/11s every day to a bunch of other people, other places.
Absolutely.
And Beauty and the Beast IMAX re-release, it also had a new song, or one of the songs from the musical, the stage musical, put into it, Human Again. They added some stuff to it, so that was part of the IMAX re-release. But Disney was really into IMAX for a brief period of time.
Really doing IMAX way the hell back in 2002?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay. At January 1st, 2000, I remember where I was. I was seeing Fantasia 2000 in IMAX. In the one IMAX theater in Florida, at the St. Augustine Golf Course was where we saw it. But it was a true IMAX screen. None of this bullshit. I see IMAX movies and pay the extra at an AMC theater. It's like a little bit bigger. It's not IMAX.
Yeah, it's real bait and switch.
Hire this fake IMAX.
Yeah, I want to be overwhelmed, and a lot of them, like, I saw Pacific Rim on a quote-unquote IMAX, and it was just the big theater. Like, that's just what it is. So probably some technical, maybe they own that theater, IMAX, I don't know.
Maybe. Maybe it's got slightly better speakers in it, but...
That sounds right, yeah.
Yeah. No, there are some real-ish IMAX theaters in San Francisco, but yeah, it's not true. But yeah, the Beauty and the Beast IMAX, I did not see that.
And Nickelback?
Yes, Nickelback. It's the era of Nickelback in 2002 is starting. Technically it's just Chad Kroeger who sings the song Hero in Spider-Man in a few months after this, but...
You know, Chad Kroeger, I love his grocery stores, hate his music. That's a little reference for all you Kroeger heads out there.
But we all remember How You Remind Me. How you remind me of how I really am.
It truly was a rotten time to be alive, wasn't it?
it was that transition time of when you were seeing new metal fade into a kind of emo metal, but not like AOR, like not like actual metal, like AM rock. And that's what Nickelback was to me. It was just like that. The cheapness of nu metal with like a certain like divorced dad emotional core to it.
It's like you're lifting weights in your new apartment after you leave your wife. That's what you blast.
Yeah, it goes from Stained to Nickelback. Like Stained was kind of the one that bridged the gap, I think.
It's the stuff divorced dads were listening to in pre-divorce times. Before they even married the wife they would later divorce, they'd listen to it in their, like, when they're 21.
They were training to be divorced in the future.
Yeah.
hit the gym every day. You know what's going to go down.
But yes, it's 2002. This is our first Simpsons of 2002.
Just a disgusting, awful year. I mean, 2002, much worse than 2001.
Yes, yeah. At least you got 8 good months of 2001 before everything got pretty bad. You got to get, you know, you got to see Shrek in theaters and so many other great things in 2001. Jesus. And it all went to hell.
And now we're in the aftermath. But joining us for this is Chris Cabot of We Hate Movies. Welcome back to the show, Chris.
Hey, fellas. Thank you for having me back.
Chris, this is a big episode because it's not only the first of 2002, but it's also the start of the Al Jean era of him as this showrunner of the show, which has been the last 2 decades of the series as well. So it's a big, big moment for the series.
It's not surprising. I had a real problem with this episode. I'll just say right off the bat. But yeah, I can see how this would connect to the current iteration.
This episode represents an important moment in Al Jean's life and an important moment for job security.
Oh, yes. Yeah. These guys would have this job forever. Yeah. And we did an entire little history on Al Jean, actually.
So now we're going to do a little thing I want to call a showrunner's corner. And this is about Al Jean, a guy we know and love and who still needs to talk to us.
Yes, yeah, still.
Even though we've never reached out yet.
Not really, no. Yeah. But, I feel like at least once or twice in the last 5 years, I have done when he's replied to me on a thing on Twitter, when I've asked him a question, which he was very nice with, I then say, hey, would you ever do an interview? I'm right here. And there's no reply. Mm. So, but the offer still stands, Al. We still, can we call you Al? That wasn't supposed to be a reference to a thing. But,
he would appreciate that kind of reference.
Yeah, actually, he would, yeah.
But yes, Alfred Ernest Jean III.
And we've covered him quite a lot in the show. But yeah, I guess, how did Al Jean go from a guy who quit the show in season 4 to the longest serving, by far, showrunner in the entire series history? And who will likely never be surpassed as I don't think anybody else will run the show for 22 years in a row like Gene did.
Well, after we're dead, it'll happen probably.
I suppose so, but I feel like Disney will have faster turnover than that. Like, you get a decade out of a person tops, you know?
Then you're paying them too much.
That's also true, yeah. But, I mean, yeah, Al Jean, the fast version of him ahead of this was, you know, he's a very, very smart young lad. Went to Harvard at, I believe, 16. Graduated at 20, comes from a Detroit, Michigan background. His dad owned a hardware store, you know, a regular dude, not one of those Harvard blue bloods, and also a big old nerd who sounds like a dork, as he said so many times in the commentaries, but he's actually a big guy.
He's a very tall man.
Yeah.
And loves comic books.
Loves comic books, yeah. We're both super fans of the Stanley and Steve Ditko era of Spider-Man, which I mainly want to just ask him about that. What's your favorite issue? Do you own Amazing Fantasy 15, Al Jean? I would think you would if I was as rich
multiple
as Al Jean.
Copies. One in each room.
But all right, so him and Mike Reese ran the show from seasons 3 and 4, and during the tail end of season 4, they worked on The Critic and were very exhausted and left the show. But as a lot of this I take from Mike Reese's book, because it charts them working together at their time away from Simpsons and why they came back. And that book's called Springfield Confidential. You should read it if you haven't yet as a Simpsons fan. So they work on The Critic at ABC. They're like, crap, this really doesn't work at ABC. Like, this just isn't the right place for it. It should be on Fox after The Simpsons. And they sign a deal to move The Critic to Fox. And that doesn't go so well for them, because the boss at Fox who approves The Critic then stops working there. The new boss doesn't like The Critic.
Mm-hmm. By the way, we have a miniseries about The Critic, Talking Critic, on the Patreon. And we cover every episode, even the web cartoons. And we tell a lot of the behind-the-scenes stories there.
At the same time as being under contract to Disney, starting in 1994, Disney allows them to do a secondary deal to create 4 episodes of The Simpsons, as well as doing various ad deals like the NFL and Major League Baseball Simpsons crossover cartoons of the mid-90s have absolutely the feel of the Al Jean writer's room on it. And honestly, that was the Billie Eilish meets the Simpsons of the 90s, really. Like, Simpsons have been doing advertorial content like this for decades.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. But they got paid very well by Disney in that overall deal. As Reese says it in his book, they pitched like 100 ideas for TV shows. Basically, none of them were made. Sounds like well-paid creative torture. Al Jean in Reese's book is quoted as saying, "A development deal is where a studio pays you a lot of money for the privilege of ruining your career." So,
well, I mean, go back to the commentaries on the record. He did not like working for Disney.
Yes, yeah, he wouldn't probably wouldn't be as negative now. No. I watched a interview with Gene where he always was the more diplomatic guy than Mike Reese in interviews, because Mike Reese in Springfield Confidential, very direct of, Matt Groening hated the critic crossover and he took his name off it. But when Gene is asked about that public fact in the Emmy Academy official interview archive, he goes like, "Well, I wouldn't speak for Matt Groening. That's his story to tell," which I was like, wow, that is the right diplomatic thing to say. This is why you're in management and Mike Reese quit showbiz.
Yeah, Mike Reese named the guy who canceled the critic. Yes. Like, it was his fault. We were doing well.
And so, yeah, it was 1998. They're working together a ton. They do the Teen Angel show. It was horrible. And so in 98, Gene and Reese's deal is up. They then have a cordial professional breakup because they had written together for like, I think like 13, 14 years professionally at that point, and even longer if you count college. But Reese was just sick of it. He couldn't stand it anymore. It did seem like absolute torture to go through that process, to try to approve with executives over and over again, like every single idea you did. And this is 20 years ago when the notes are even less bad than they are now.
Yeah, Teen Angel broke him, and we might be looking at it.
Yeah.
Its 25th anniversary is coming up this fall.
I hope to look at it soon. Yeah, but and so Gene decides, while Reese is going to just quit Hollywood and travel the world with his wife, Al Jean is going to go back to The Simpsons. And, you know, Mike Scully even mentioned to us in our interview with him, like, you know, once Al Jean was available, yes, we were going to hire him back. Like, he could definitely be trusted as a co-executive producer on the show to handle stuff as needed. And I think they could trust him to do a pretty good job. Though it's funny, Mike Reese, I think, basically quit show business for like 18 months and then he just couldn't not do it. He's like, no, I have to do it. And the year 2000 was when he started his one day a week rewrite room gig at The Simpsons. Al then came in season 10 and he would officially become showrunner with season 13, but it's just like, I think he was doing light showrunning. I think Scully gave him some episodes to do like co-showrunner work on, because I call this back to the deleted scenes in season 12. Gene comments on why scenes were deleted more than Scully does.
Oh, which, okay.
That's the call made by a showrunner, right?
Right. Yeah. I assume he was given just a very senior role before he was a showrunner.
He certainly wasn't like, well, you're a staff writer, Gene. Back to the end of the line for you. But of course, Al couldn't be a full-time showrunner because him, Mike Reese, and James L. Brooks signed a big, big deal for some wonderful internet money.
Oh, no.
They signed an overall deal. Gracie Films signed an overall deal with Shockwave in March of 2000. That somehow turned into the gig at Icebox.
Right. So those were the NFTs of their day.
Yeah.
Like this giant scam that caused the bubble to burst. And so many Simpsons writers are attached to those Icebox shows.
Yeah, yeah.
They're now forgotten. Some of them are on YouTube that like illegally uploaded, but it was a rotten time.
You can go to the Icebox official website still and find some of them. You can't find Mr. Wong.
I'm still waiting for the conclusion to Zombie College.
And Gene's one episode story, Jesus and His Brothers, is still on there if you want to see
it. What about Hard Drinking Lincoln? That was Reese's cartoon.
I think it's still there. I think it is. I did see Bill Corbett did the one of the dog, or he's part of it, the poker playing dogs one. I remember that one.
There was a lot of those. Everyone was getting these deals for web cartoons if you had any TV experience in the year 2000.
And Gene said it took forever. It took longer to make than an episode of The Simpsons, which he was told, like, no, the internet's supposed to be fast. Like, I don't understand this. But once the Icebox deal was dead and right right before September 11th. I think that's when Gene is freed up to be a full-time showrunner again. And on top of that, as Scully told us in one of our interviews with him, Scully kept thinking the show was going to end and he didn't want to leave the series to like a one-season showrunner for the last season. But then it just kept going.
Yeah.
And so he's like, well, if I ever want to make a show of my own, which, you know, a foolish thing to do, you should just stay at The Simpsons forever and keep collecting them big fat paychecks.
And this is Gene's first episode as solo showrunner. And it's funny because I was online at the time, very online in the Simpsons fan communities. And we thought, oh, thank God Al Jean is coming to rescue us from the evil Mike Scully. Not really remembering that, oh, yeah, Al Jean's been on the show for 2 years before he takes over as showrunner. Mm-hmm. But here's the thing, like the tone of the show doesn't really change because nothing fundamentally will change about The Simpsons, as Joe Biden has said in the past. Nothing fundamentally changed. It's just like Mike's Al Jean's now in charge. Mike Scully's gone. All the writers remain the same. So there's no real shift in tone. Everyone online thought like, oh, finally back to regular, you know, down to earth stories. That does not happen. I'm not going to say that's good or bad, but there's no change in tone because the staff is essentially the same.
Yeah. Yeah. And on top of that, the culture they're in is the same too, which is a darker, dirtier culture. And I mean, as well, definitely in 2001, when you hear Al Jean's coming back, you're just remembering, season 3 and 4, the best seasons. And they are very, 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 very great. But when we have watched them with a fine-tooth comb, you do see the flaws that Al Jean will bring to these. And on top of that, he now lacks Mike Reese, who I do think was, you know, both of them I think had their good traits, but especially from reading Reese's Springfield Confidential, I think the balance he gave to Al Jean was he is a meaner, more cynical guy.
Yeah.
Who, like, is, and also that he, how many stories have we heard him say just on commentaries of like, I thought that joke sucked and wanted to cut it. And we're thinking he was probably right and they should have cut it.
Most of the time, I agree with him on those commentaries when he says, you know, why did we keep this? Yeah. This is so bad. And I think, like, Al Jean is a good manager in the sense that he wants to keep everybody happy. And maybe that, to spare people's feelings, you keep in some jokes that you would otherwise savage in the writer's room. It's like, it's fine for now. Let's move on. And also, he's an older guy taking over the show, just like Mike Scully. These shows are not run by people in their 20s who can, you know, stay until 3 a.m. or single guys like Dave Merkin who can also stay till 3 a.m.
Yeah.
Al Jean has a family, he's got young children, and he's keeping the same hours as Mike Scully. They're working very hard, but the show, the culture has changed from the 90s.
Oh yeah.
And there was like a crunch, like comedy crunch on this show in the 90s.
Yes, yeah, there's just so many sitcoms going on, there's not a lot of people to hire. I was thinking that too, of like, you know, the mental exercise of let's go back to 2001. Who do you pick? Like, we already know that you get the feeling that James L. Brooks wasn't in love with what Oakley and Weinstein did.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
So it doesn't seem like he'd want to pick another couple of young guys to do it, which is certainly what Matt Selman, who at the time was 31, would have been. And most of the other guys around him too, who'd never showrun before, which is Oakley and Weinstein had never showrun before too. And I think we would both agree, did an amazing job, but not according to the guy who hires people.
Yeah, I think Dave Merkin was the only guy with showrunning experience that they hired as showrunner.
Yeah.
Except for like Sam Simon, of course, and James L. Brooks.
And that was, and I mean, yeah, and on top of that, it's like, well, it seems like George Meyer doesn't want to be the boss. Like, I don't think he did. He co-showrun some stuff with, well, he's like co-EP with Scully, but I don't think he's showrunner. I also think, you know, from the description of him as a writer, he doesn't sound like a guy who wants to be management, I don't think.
I don't think so.
And then the only other co-EP in the previous season is Ian Maxtone Graham, who would have been far worse than Al Jean, I would say.
I think so.
Well, let's not say far worse, but I would bet he'd be worse. And so then you're just left with, like, you know, as Dan Graney called him, and I'll never forget it, when we asked him, like, how does Al Jean compare as a showrunner to Mike Scully? He said, like, Al Jean, steady Eddie. You know, he just makes sure it gets out, the thing's finished, you get it on time. That's what you count on with Al Jean. It's consistency, you know?
And he's kept the show popular
and profitable.
For all these years, and profitable too.
Yeah.
He's always got these numbers.
He does. Oh, yes. Yeah. He's a very statistic based guy, I would say, which, I mean, hey, he's a Harvard graduate.
He's a bachelor's in mathematics from Harvard. So,
of course, he's saying, like, and you know what? Ratings did this year, and or we won this many Emmys. So if you're saying, since I came back on, so if you're saying we suck now, maybe the Emmys think we are stupid too then, huh? Like, that was actually basically one of his acceptance speeches I saw. But so yeah, Al taking over the job, that happened officially announced by in Variety April 30th 2001, though likely set into motion a little before that. So that would stay that way April 2001 basically to 2020, I think, or even 2021, when Matt Selman, it seemed like, I think in season 31, got to showrun a handful of episodes, but now it's half showrunning. Selman showruns half the series, and Gene does the other. And it sounds like it's just, you've got two bosses. It's the same pack of writers, but you got two different bosses doing it. And you know what? You can't tell all the time, but I definitely can tell mostly the difference between a Gene and a Selman episode, I think. You know, usually.
Yeah, I think so.
And I think it also frees up Al Jean to work on advertorial junk also, which is what he's very busy with.
And the shorts, which are, I guess, advertorials.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
Yes.
Yeah. And you know what? Selman, he's a spry 50 to Al Jean 61.
Let's get this young buck out there. Running some shows.
And yeah, you know what? I would say my diagnosis on Gene is, like, I think he's a better manager than a comedy writer these days. Like, I think he's good. And I think he gets a little too into focus testing, really.
Yeah.
Like, I think that's a problem.
The movie was evidence of that.
Yes.
For sure. And yes, we'll talk about it. We've already talked about it on two other podcasts, but we'll talk about it on our own. I don't know, about 5 years.
Yeah. And though, you know what? I also want to say, when I think of, like, why was Gene different from season 4 Al Jean to the, you know, season 13 showrunner Al Jean, it's not just that he lost Mike Reese. I do think Disney's psychological torture of during that development deal, I literally makes you doubt your abilities.
Yeah,
like, if
you
had every boss above you for 5 years saying, like, this sucks, I'll never make it, you should do this, not that, I feel like that would fuck you up. You know?
That's a good point. I mean, I respect Al Jean and I really enjoy the work he's done, but a hallmark I view in his work from this period onward is a lack of confidence.
Yes,
they should have every right to be confident for being on The Simpsons and for being a successful show for that long.
Yeah.
There's no reason you shouldn't be confident, but for some reason, maybe it was a psychological torture, making Teen Angel, all these executives telling him, your show sucks, you're not funny.
Mm.
I mean, we talked about this on the Critic miniseries, but the president of Fox brought them into a room, screened the critic, and he's like, you tell me why you think this is funny.
Yes. Yeah. I do think that has an effect on you. I mean, Reese quits, like, Hollywood because of that too. And yeah, I think, you know, we as Simpsons fans have some of the blame for his psychological makeup too. Like, doubting himself is also because he didn't read probably one good review of his shows for a long time, or every interview he gave from 1999 to now has one question of, so why does your show suck now, or why is it not as good,
exactly,
or when are you gonna quit doing it?
Like, and I know his canned response, because he's got to say it every time. It's like, well, people said that we sucked in season 4, but our shows were great and they're still great. I mean, like, on a personal level, when we do the Simpsons podcast, occasionally people are tactless and they'll be like, oh, good luck with that, guys, wait till you get to the bad episodes, your podcast is gonna end, and then they laugh and we're like, hey, this is our jobs. Like, at every party and every interview, his peers, you know, media, they're always saying, your show stinks, what's going on, why do you still have a job, fucker? So it's gotta be like a million times worse than for him.
Yeah, I'd also say that in the last few years, I think somebody told Al Jean, you got to get better PR, because his initial response to the problem with Apu and the critiques in that was not good. And I think I believe he learned some lessons from that. So that was good. But also, yes, I think it's funny that this commentary features Al Jean talking about the literal stagnation of Simpsons hiring and how there's only so many guys they hire, and then they don't hire nobody else, and everybody, no one wants to leave the job. So I thought that was funny too.
I mean, I really see him becoming the Lorne Michaels figure of the show. Like, even if he leaves a hands-on showrunning role, I feel like he'll always be behind the scenes as, like, the puppet master, you know?
Yeah.
He is the face of the show.
Yeah, and I mean, I do the math on this. James L. Brooks just turned 82. You know, that's not a young man. I am sure he's taking great care of himself, all that stuff, but it's like, you know, if Al Jean's 61, what if Brooks retires and he's like, hey, okay, Al, you can do this for 20 years and then, I don't know, put the 73-year-old Matt Selman as the steward of it. But yeah, I definitely think Al is being groomed to be the future James L. Brooks holding the fort down for the next 20 years until, you know, 2042. And at that point, what even is entertainment at all? You know, I have no fucking idea.
I like the show before it was all holograms.
Yes.
Or yeah. Holograms.
Holograms, yeah. But yeah, so this is the start of the Gene era, though. This is where we're in, and we're going to be in it for a long, long, long time.
There will be no other showrunner corners. This is the only one.
I guess in 2040, when we get to it, well, with Selman's first showrun episode in like season 30, I guess. But yep, so hey, enjoy it, folks. There's also another thing to note about this episode in the start of season 13 that I learned through my Gene research, which is I think season 12 was nearly the last one because they didn't sign the cast members to a new deal until right before season 13 started. If you remember in season 10, the Simpsons cast was threatening to strike if they did not get a raise, and a big one, and they were all going to do it together, and they got it. And the idea of the deal was that if they make it to season 13, they're all going to get a big raise and a bonus. And if I know studio executives, they would cancel a show just because of that. They were going to have to give $100,000 extra to all six voice actors and $1 million bonus to each of them if they made it to a 13th season. So the fact that they did do that and factor that into the math, I think that shows you that Fox was way more behind Simpsons in season 13 than you would have thought in season 10.
And now they've all taken pay cuts, right?
After season 13, it went up and up and up and up, like creeping up to like $250 per episode. And then I think that's when, Fox came to them with outturned pockets, like, we can't afford to pay you more. You gotta, they actually put all the weight on the actors to say, like, if you guys don't take pay cuts, and we're gonna fire everybody. So how you like that? Like,
yeah, we're just a widow TV station. We don't have anything. Please don't. Please don't bankrupt us.
This little place is falling apart.
Yes. Yep. Yeah. It's they gave everybody a raise. They renewed it for three more seasons when they did that. So and also they signed up Dan Castellaneta and his wife Deb LaCosta to an overall deal to produce things for Fox. Seemingly nothing came of that, but
they'll write a clip show pretty soon.
Oh,
right?
I bet you that's part of that deal. I bet you. And also a big part of signing that deal, as reported in Variety in April of 2001, there's a backdoor clause in there that in those three seasons they might start production on a movie, but that'll never happen.
Nope.
No, never.
And I was also trying to think, like, why else would Fox do this? And it's like the Variety article says that it is still the highest rated show in the 18 to 49 demographic Fox has. So they're like, well, we got to keep it for that reason. And additionally, at this time, they're selling those DVDs now. 2001 is the first year they sell DVDs. And that they have to be thinking, if we make a season 13 and we sell those DVDs, we sell millions of those, that already paid for this season of it. So I would bet to a degree the DVDs probably saved the Simpsons as well and let it continue to lucky season 13.
I think you're totally right. DVDs resurrected Family Guy and Futurama. They definitely extended the life of the Simpsons.
For sure.
Oh, 100%. I remember the Walmart near my high school. You could go there at midnight. The night before it was going to come out, and you could buy the new Simpsons. And I saw kids, a bunch of kids there when I went to do it for season specifically. I remember seasons 3 and 4, but like I assume it was there for first and second. Like it was a big deal that the Simpsons was on DVD.
Oh, that's awesome, man. I should have done, I would just go to the Best Buy on opening day or the opening hour of it. I should have gone to my local 24-hour Walmart instead and just been there at 1 in the morning and the big
warehouse ones. Yeah.
I guess to give some context about DVDs, to go on a side tangent here, it was a novelty to get an entire season season on DVD for like $30 in 2001. Now, when you like check out of a store, there's like, here's all of Night Court for $3. Just take it. Just shoplift it. We don't care. But in 2001, it's like, I think like things like The Sopranos or The X-Files are in these big expensive $200 box sets. But The Simpsons was like a reasonably priced DVD box set. I think helped influence how those releases would be handled in the future.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
There's like, huge warehouses all over this great nation full, and everybody thinks they're like data farms and like places where like Bitcoin is being produced, or not anymore, I guess. But but I'm telling you, it's all like Ark of the Covenant style boxes of these DVDs that they printed en masse of TV shows. Nobody really wanted after maybe like the first wave of fans like wanted the first season of ER or something like that. And so they did that. Like, there's just, I can't imagine how many fucking box sets there are out there just rotting away.
Just the three city blocks holding nothing but Northern Exposure DVDs.
No, yeah, I've noticed on Black Friday kind of sales that it'll just be like, here's all of Mary Tyler Moore for $20. Like, you can just have it. I know we sold them season one, it's $60, but now you can have the whole thing just right here.
Actually, to help promote a We Hate Movies project, so We Hate Movies, Chris, you guys do the Melrose 210 podcast about Melrose Place and Beverly Hills 90210. I'm going through that with my wife, and she's been buying the Melrose Place and 90210 DVD box sets. It is a buyer's market on those, my friend.
Oh man,
you can get those for about $8 a season.
Yeah, I think Steve has gone purchased that finally. I mean, he was really the heart and soul behind it. He really was like, this, we have to watch these. And I think actually the box sets are maybe the only way you are going to get a copy of the when Scotty kills himself in Beverly Hills 90210, because they scrubbed that from streaming. Watch it anywhere.
A few Too Hot for TV episodes that they Too Hot for 2022 TV episodes that they are on the DVDs.
Yeah, not too hot for DVD. DVD was never too, you could do whatever the fuck you liked on
it. Yeah, that was the go-go 2003. You
they could sell 2 hours of Kevin Smith talking to people. It was crazy. And they did it multiple times.
Many times. In many countries.
Yeah. And I bought one of them.
I at least rented a few. I sent it to you.
The Simpsons will be right back.
New from Kellogg's, No Problemos. Yummy loops and chocolatey biscuits. Do anything to get your hands on them. New Bart Simpson's No Problemos. There's a bit of Bart in every box.
It's Henry Gilbert. Welcome to the break, and a big thank you to the angel who visited us this week, Chris Cabin from We Hate Movies. Everybody follow at Crabbin on Twitter, and please check out We Hate Movies if you haven't yet. They do so much cool stuff both on the free feed and on their Patreon. And if you guys enjoy this podcast, Talking Simpsons is only available to you thanks to the many great supporters at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Folks on there make this possible as me and Bob's full-time jobs, and they also get tons of extras, like they can hear next week's episode of Talking Simpsons right now without ads like this one. Plus, they get a giant back catalog of exclusive monthly podcasts like Talking Futurama and Talk King of the Hill, where me and Bob cover an episode of Futurama and an episode of King of the Hill once a month, only for our Patreon subscribers. And you'll get the whole back catalog of it, as well as all the episodes we did covering The Critic, Mission Hill, and our 10 favorite episodes of Batman the Animated Series, all at your fingertips if you sign up at that $5 level today at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. But if you want something as nice as a Band on the Run CD, then you should sign up at the premium level on patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, because there you get all the $5 things I just talked about, and then you get our premium monthly What a Cartoon Movie podcast, where we go super duper in depth into an animated feature film just like we do with The Simpsons. That often results in film talk that goes over 5 or even 6 hours long. We're that crazy. 6.5 hours of talk about Who Framed Roger Rabbit happened just this year. year, the month after that, we did 6 hours of talk on Toy Story 3. And at the end of this month, you'll hear us chatting about The Little Mermaid, the 1989 Disney classic. If you sign up now, you get access to those recent ones, plus almost 4 years worth of What a Cartoon Movie back catalog of us covering animated feature films as in-depth as End of Evangelion or Beavis and Butthead to America, Akira or a Goofy movie, Batman Beyond, Return of the Joker, or Kiki's Delivery Service. A huge selection for you to check out. Please sign up today at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons at the premium level to check out everything you're missing out on. That's patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Hey, it's funny. I think this segues well into another preamble thing. Talk about DVDs. We talk about DVD extras and that DVD commentaries.
Oh,
we don't often spotlight the commentaries on this podcast with actual clips, but this one is so funny or has so many funny moments in it that of cringiness that it's actually worth spotlighting.
It's so awkward. Delroy Lindo, I don't think he knows what a commentary is or why he's supposed to be there, but I think he thinks it's his role to ask questions.
Yeah.
And then not be very pleased with the answers.
Yes. Yeah. I don't know if you gave a listen to it, Chris. Maybe we should have been, sorry, we're springing this on you now. Did you listen to that commentary?
Please. I didn't get this far into the DVDs. No, I have not heard this one.
Delroy Lindo, who is like an amazing actor. I love it. Every time I see him in something, he's great, I think.
Incredible.
But he's a little older than but not that old. He's not like ancient. But I think that he comes off on the commentary as thinking like this is a phone interview, not actually saying I see a thing on screen and now let's talk about it. And he's kind of like asking questions to the guys like, so how long you worked on this show, did you think it was going to be this successful?
I don't know. It's not clear if he knows that it's still on TV, because at one point he asked like, did this help you with your careers, are you doing other things? I think he's got a low opinion of the Simpsons, actually, it feels like, with his leading questions. But it's an awkward commentary. If you haven't heard it, it's kind of unsatisfying, but it is funny. It's the one commentary I can think of where a guest says, can I go now?
Yes. Yeah. So I have three favorites here. This one first is just the general tone of Delroy Lindo saying how much he wasn't that excited about doing this podcast or this commentary.
As a result of the fact that my niece and my nephew's in Philadelphia, all of a sudden, I got all kinds of cred because I had done The Simpsons.
Oh, that's great.
So when they called me and said, oh, Uncle Delroy, you're really cool, man. You did The Simpsons. That's when I watched it. It was probably weeks, maybe even months after it had originally aired. So that's the answer to your question.
He does a lot of that. Like, so that's the answer to your question.
Yeah.
Like, just to kind of
there'll be no further discussion.
Maybe it just had a really bad day. Maybe the car didn't start that morning. I mean, I don't know. That definitely seems like he did not want. I mean, I guess that's like the go-to answer when you did something either for credit or for money, is that like, oh, well, my nieces or my son or my daughter, mm-hmm. it loves this thing. And they had to see me do it. Like that. I remember Tommy Lee Jones saying that's why he did Two-Face, and of course it wasn't the dump truck of money.
No.
Was that his son was so into it, but that is hilarious. That's how
I mean, this is late 2009 he's doing this. This is before most people have to be on Zoom or Skype, right, or video chat. So it's new to him. And he's got also has a bad connection. They keep losing him. So I think he's annoyed by that, too.
Yeah, sure. I think his assistant or somebody keeps setting it back up for him. And he's like, well, also, as I learned in my research of Delroy Lindo, is that I believe since 2001, he's lived where me and Bob live in Oakland, California. So it's not even like he's far from Hollywood. At this time, well, I guess not that far, but this is the longest clip I have of him on the commentary. But his thoughts on what his character looks like is very funny here.
All right, so here's the question, because here I'm just on screen. I just came on screen.
I know,
when I watched it, I actually watched it this morning in anticipation of coming to do this. And what occurred to me was that my voice seemed not to. When I look at the image of the character I was playing and I listen to my voice coming out of that character's mouth, it didn't quite add up. So my question, in other words, the character doesn't sound like he looks. And there's no reason, there's no rule that says I should. But my question is, when you're casting these guest parts, do you go for a voice that will sound, quote unquote, the way that the character looks? Or are you going for, you know, some kind of a name or what? Or all of the above or what?
We design the characters after. I just want to say, we design the characters after we hear the voices. So,
really?
I'm sorry it didn't work out for you. We thought we did pretty good.
Can we go back and do it again?
I'm working on it right now. I'm going to read the character.
Perfect.
Yeah, it sounds like he's either saying, you guys messed up, or you miscast me. You should have never cast me for this drawing. I mean, he's really holding their feet to the fire. I will say, Al Jean, he is the show's diplomat. For all of these kind of slightly rude and leading questions, he has a good answer for all of them in a way to spare the feelings of the people Delroy might be insulting.
Yes.
I mean, that would be tough for me. That is absolute professional managerial skills right there, is being able to walk out of that and not like I got offended right there. incredible. I mean, it's incredible that he said that.
Yeah, I just love his question where he's like, when I was watching this show, and I actually watched it, by the way, it seems like you guys didn't do a good job. Can you explain that?
Yeah. I also love that, like, that was Silverman doing most of the talking and the response to him there. And that David Silverman, the artist in the room, I think that he's being a little, like, pointedly defensive of, like, well, we do try to make it look like you, and I'm sorry it didn't fit the voice. We tried. Like, yeah, which...
I do have to say, I kind to agree with him a little. I think Delroy might be correct. Now that he brings, like, now thinking about it, it is weird that the whole time I felt a disconnect between the character and the voice. I mean, I guess maybe it's just because Delroy Lindo's voice has been in my head since I was a tiny kid. Like, I just remember him since forever being in everything. I mean, I don't know, but it's funny that when he said it, I was like, wait, he might be right on that.
Maybe the unspoken thing is they wanted Morgan Freeman, and the character was designed to be a little Morgan Freeman-y.
Yes.
I wonder.
That feels, the look is much more Morgan Freeman-y.
Yes, yeah. I mean, on some level, I thought maybe Linda was saying, well, shouldn't you just draw this to just look like me? Why does this guy, like, say, have hair? Because I don't have hair. Like, or why does he have a gray mustache? I have a cool black mustache. Like, you know?
Yeah, it struck me as, again, it also just might be that I'm so connected to Delroy Lindo as a character actor that I just can't separate him from his actual image. Like, that really might be it.
I mean, I love him, and every time I see him in something, I love it. But yeah, I think, and then this is the last bit where, so when there's 4 minutes left in the commentary, and it's only 22 minutes, Delroy is looking a little tired, I think, in this last clip of the commentary.
Have we covered it, fellas, or what?
I think that's about it. Well, if there's anything more you want to say, we'd be happy to hear. I mean,
I'm good. I'm good.
That's it.
So not even saying goodbye.
No. Nope. Yeah.
Yeah, I've never heard anyone on a commentary say, hey, we're done.
Yeah.
Is this all you need? It's like, do you have anything else you want to say? No. No, not even like it was fun to be on the show, or you know, great job, you guys. No, absolutely not. No. I just want to go home. We normally don't talk about the commentaries. I mean, we reference things said on them, but not the way people are acting, or you know, the way people want to leave. But this is the one time it's like we need to get clips.
Yes,
because this is just very odd.
So it's really funny. I don't know. It's funny to hear, and yeah, like and I think. A downside to having Delroy Lindo for a star-studded commentary, the downside is that they can't really talk much about the creation of this episode, so we can only make some informed guesses, but definitely Al Jean wanted to deal with the hanging thread of the Vegas wives, and I think in general, based on what he said in many other commentaries, you were mentioning this too to me, Bob, that like I think Al Jean always says that when a new showrunner comes on this show, he goes, he or they say, we're going to focus back on the family again.
We're like, bringing it back.
Yeah, we're bringing it back to the family.
And every time it's a lie.
Yes. Yeah. So, and this episode feels so disparate. It's like, we always say like act one has a crazy unrelated thing, but like act two is wholly unrelated to act three. Like it's just three separate stories that kind of don't touch each other.
Yeah, the guest star is only in the second act. And yeah, it is a real, also a real Algene tendency in his seasons to quote unquote fix what he views as loose threads. So we have the Vegas wives, Barney will become drunk again, which I approve of. Milhouse's parents get back together. Like he's trying to, you know, bring things back to the status quo that other showrunners might have changed throughout the way.
But this feels like a test reel. Like this feels like a patchwork of like from different episodes they started and then had to stop for some reason. Because if he was trying to bring it back, like what I remember about early or what I think I go back is that those 25 to 30 minute like narrative arcs, like, and like, yeah, there were ones that were split up, but like it was strong throughout. This is just like it's changing from like every 5 minutes the story changes.
That is also, I think, another tendency of this Algene era is that I feel like a lot of the times every act is a different story. A hallmark of the show was the first act with its own set piece that led you to the rest of the story. They find the story in the first act. They go to like a fair, or they go to a rock concert, or they go to the park, and that's where the story picks up in the second act. This one, it's like act one, what do the Simpsons do on a rainy day? Act two, how do the Simpsons become a family through this family bonding exercise? Act three, how do they get rid of these sluts that are stuck in their house? That's in the show's terms. We should respect these sex workers in the show.
I agree. Yes.
Oh, 100%. I mean, I think this is a pretty mean-spirited episode. Like when it is deciding to take sides on something, I find it a pretty mean-spirited episode.
Oh yeah. Hey, Act Three is canceled in 2022. We'll talk more about that soon.
But I guess this episode begins with something that was definitely written before 9/11, because after 9/11, the Simpsons were not, for a little bit, they were not as mean to Republicans as they had been. And this airs months after 9/11, but was certainly written in like April or May of 2001.
Definitely reflecting upon George W. Bush in his early few months before 9/11, and also reflecting upon his bad record with the environment. I mean, that was a big part of the 2000 election cycle. Al Gore was strong on the environment. George W. Bush was weak. And this is written right after George W. Bush pulls America out of the Kyoto Protocol.
Right.
So man, I think that's what this whole act is hinging upon. And, you know, looking back at the just horrors of history, I just looking into the history of the Kyoto Protocol, like Obama made a ton of promises about the environment. And then when it came back to joining the Kyoto Protocol, he was like, actually, I agree with George W. Bush about this. And I'm not going to do it. So and people were like, what a smart man.
Yeah.
He's shaking hands across the aisle and fucking over the environment. You know what? Every time 30% of our state burns down every year, I'm like, thank God Obama did not join the Kyoto Protocol and, you know, ravage the economy. It really sucks, folks.
Yes.
It's terrible.
Now, these
weird that Obama would do something like that.
Yeah,
I know.
He's known for doing things constantly.
And then it's great seeing him in speeches in 2021 of like, you guys, you got to work on the environment. It's in trouble. We need a future. It's like you were the president. You were the
I mean, there are much worse presidents. There was a much worse president, of course. But it's also shocking when you go back and say, "Oh, I thought he was the guy he was supposed to do stuff."
Yeah. Well, we let him down, as we all know. But I look back at these jokes from 20 years ago about like, boy, the climate's getting worse, guys. I'm like, you don't fucking know. You have no clue.
I am glad that they're at least putting blame where it should be on Ralph Nader. Who is clearly like the great demon of the fucking early aughts.
These are like, those are like the Jill Stein jokes of today.
Which also Algene did in when that time came in the show too. So
or getting really mad at Susan Sarandon online.
Yeah. Which Susan Sarandon loves the Simpsons. She wears her jacket everywhere, you know? It shouldn't be so mean to her. But yeah, let's hear our first clip of the return to the Republican castle, last seen in season 6's Sideshow Bob Roberts.
Let's get started. First, I'd like to announce that thanks to the magic of Disney animatronics, Strom Thurmond will live another 100 years.
20 more terms.
Moving on to new business, what act of unmitigated evil shall the Republican Party undertake this week?
Oh, Oh.
You've already done enough, Nader.
Let's get rid of PBS. Those lousy Muppets have been taking food out of my mouth for too long.
I say we crack down on the hippies. Blah.
What about this dang environment? Back in Texas, we got rid of it, and it made everyone a lot happier. We were so happy out here.
Excellent. We shall destroy the environment by scrapping every anti-pollution law. Now, Bob Dole will read from the Necronomicon.
Hey, Zach, Azuri, Galanath, Maledictu, Nosferamus, and Principi.
I love that. I just like him doing the Bob Dole voice.
Just to spite us, Bob Dole died 2 months after Norm Macdonald.
Evil.
Or three
evil.
Months. Yeah.
I hate it. And of course he lived that longer than him, of course. God, hate it.
He was just waiting around for Norm to die, I bet. That was just one of those little bets he had with him, like just in the background. You never knew. I got to tell you, it took me looking this up to find out that Strom Thurmond was still alive in 2002. That really shocked me. And that he was alive. He didn't die until the summer after. Like 2003, I think he died.
Famously, Joe Biden's best friend, Strom Thurmond.
Eulogized proudly by him. Yeah.
And we knew a lot about Strom Thurmond in his past, but it all came out, a lot of the more steamy stuff came out after he was dead, where in 2003, it was revealed that he had an illegitimate child with a black woman. It could have been statutory rape. They don't know the age of the woman. He was 22. She was either 15 or 16. If she was 16, it was legal. If she was 15, that's statutory rape. And then he goes on to, like, you know, kind of give her money behind the scenes to help raise the kid. And then in 2017, he's been dead for 14 years. He's canceled from beyond the grave. He gets MeToo'd.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, I missed this.
Yeah. Finally. Like, all of this stuff came out about him, like, groping women, forcing himself on women, trying to kiss women. Cokie Roberts, the journalist, said when it came to that, he was in a league of his own.
Jesus, man.
And she talked about how Strom, this disgusting ghoul, tried to kiss her on the mouth. So God. He was canceled from beyond the grave.
God damn it.
In 2017.
I mean, when we all looked at him then, we knew he was, like, one of the most evil living beings you could imagine. But to now have this information, exactly, God, what the worst fucking guy. Like a obscenely racist, just awful, awful man. There to be racist and prevent any type of progress as best he can, especially on race. Like, yeah, just awful. But that's why when he does 20 more terms, I feel like a toothier joke would have been him saying something racist. Like,
yeah.
It was them just saying, oh, he's just old. Like, it was like an old joke, just be right up front and called Strom Thurmond a racist. We all know it. Like, come on.
I mean,
like,
that's what I kind of did. This was an early warning sign to me of what was happening in the episode, because there are no points really to the joke. Like, even the Bob Dole thing, which I also think is funny as, like, pure delivery, but, like, there's no point to, like, there's no, like, stinger at the end of the joke. It's literally just him reading from what the Necronomicon would sound like. And like, I'm just like, well, where's the sting? Where's, like, the button? Where's the exclamation point? Where's any of that? And it all just kind of seemed very flatline from the beginning.
Well, I guess they're just generally evil. Like, that is it. Like, Republicans are just generally evil, and that's it.
Some of it is because reality has outpaced satire by quite a bit, where this joke about Krusty wanting to, like, shut down the Muppets for stealing from him, taking money out of his pockets, that was like a campaign promise of Mitt Romney in 2020. He directly threatened Big Bird. He directly said, we're going to cut the subsidies to PBS.
Yeah. No, and Trump wanted to do the same thing. Some people thought he'd pull it off, but apparently he did. Not that, like, when I looked into this, only 15% of PBS is paid for by the government anyway, and the rest is from viewers like you. Biden has said he planned to boost it some, but I couldn't see if that was, like, you know, he gets so many headlines on, like, Biden's budget says it'll do this. I was like, well, did that budget go through? I'm not sure.
Well, you know, just like prisons, Sesame Street was privatized.
Yes.
That's why Big Bird sells you DoorDash or whatever.
No, Sesame Street, you know, PBS defensively will say that new episodes are released 9 months after on PBS, so it's just that HBO Max has a timed exclusive, guys.
You poor kids gotta wait.
and also HBO gets a ton of exclusive Sesame Street news shows, like that Elmo talk show thing that's on HBO Max. But yes, Jesus. I'm sure Jim Henson would have wanted it this way. Mm-hmm. That's for sure.
But, oh yeah, he would have loved all this shit. Does PBS get like the Sopranos or Peacemaker in 9-1-2, or is it just the Sesame Street?
That should be part of the deal, man. I would hope at least public broadcasting gets a little money back that they can then put into other shows by selling Sesame Street like that. But I mean, yeah, but Chris, yeah, the teeth on this are just saying like, hey, we can mock red staters for their hate of the environment. Like that's an easy, you know, if we're going to talk about, you know, say invasions of countries or abortion, that might piss off some red state viewers, but environment, not easy enough, you know?
Yeah, that's easy enough to, you can do soft hits on that. And I mean, not even to say that like there is weirdly an abortion joke in this, but it's like weirdly coded. You have to know, like you would have to know what the drug was called.
You got to Google.
It's also kind of like slut shaming someone for wanting to use it.
Yes.
In a way.
Yes, it is. But we'll get to that.
Though also on the environmental thing, I mean, it was the administration full of literal oil executives. Like Dick Cheney ran the Energy Task Force. Like it was, it's hard to remember exactly how awful W was in those specific ways. Even when I looked up this, I was like, oh yeah, that is really bad. That was really bad. We're just used to how bad things are now that I forgot how they made this bad. Like the W and his administration did that. But you know,
it's like bathwater. You get used to it.
Well, I mean, that's the thing. Like, I remember the Bush era being the first time where, like, you were being asked to describe something while everything was exploding. Like, that's how you could pay attention. That's the only way you could pay attention to what was going on. So much shit was happening, and you were asked to pay attention to all of it. And now that is just what you are expected to do as a human being who is attached to the internet. But, like, that was the first time where I was like, oh, fuck, I have to read a paper every day. Oh, fuck, I have to check this website every day. Oh, fuck, I have to do, like, I just, constantly in my head being about that.
There's a new Michael Moore book?
Yes.
I just read one. Al Franken too?
They also, I noted that Brockman said the administration. It could be that they didn't want to be so negative on directly George Bush, or it could be that they're like, well, it would date it if we said George W. Bush did this. If you say the administration, then it works forever. You know, it's like you're being vague. But they introduced Choppy the lumberjack who murders a hippie on screen, which I gotta say, see, this is again, they're slight left punching. The conservationist could just be right, but they instead have to make him a whiny hippie.
Yeah.
I like Homer's note on a grizzly bear with a chainsaw. Now there's a killing machine. Nelson bullies an endangered owl. I mean, this definitely notes that, like, the 90s are over. We don't care anymore. Like, forget, fuck these endangered animals. Fuck these wetlands. You know, I write a positive thing about the wetlands, which have been shrinking forever, but they're starting to grow again in Florida thanks to rising sea levels. So
this is good for everyone.
Always this a episode, silver lining.
Yeah, definitely. This episode was nominated for an Environmental Media Award, a fact that Al Jean was kind of ashamed of, because he said they were nominated just for these scenes, just a bunch of jokey scenes about, you know, devastation of the environment. They lost to a Dharma and Greg episode, by the way.
I mean,
back in the time when you had to worry about competition from Dharma and Greg, I mean, that alone is a shock to the system.
That show had some Emmy heat behind it. Sorry, Chris.
Do they still? I was trying to look into this because I saw this thing about the environmental award. I couldn't find anything about winner, like down the line winners. Like I think you have to do like isolated searches. Like it screams like money laundering or something weird. Because I'm like, why would you have this specifically for a TV show that is literally like, you know, the environment can be hurt and it can hurt us back. And that's essentially all that they're telling you.
Well, you know, filmmakers and TV makers have such a carbon footprint they feel guilty about. They have to give themselves awards sometimes to feel less guilty. You know?
I suppose that's true.
Apparently, the other thing in the category that was nominated was an episode of Becker.
Becker?
Ooh, Becker.
Becker.
Okay. Yeah, there's some other funny gags. The Blinky, the fish dies, is eaten by a four-eyed fish, eaten by a six-eyed fish that then Homer eats. This also feels, this whole run reminds me of the opening to the Simpsons movie. Like, it's a lot of environmental jokes there, too.
Yes. Good point.
And then comes in Acid Rain, which... So I look this up. It's like there's multiple articles from the last few years called like, why did acid rain go away? You never hear about it anymore. And in America, let's not celebrate too soon, but apparently America actually with emissions laws kind of did curtail acid rain in this country. Like it apparently still happens to some degree in the Northeast in some more industrial areas, but it actually doesn't happen in that much in North America comparatively to 25 years ago. Though in other parts of the globe, acid rain is still very much a reality, especially, say, in industrialized parts of India and China from my research. But so if you're like, oh, acid rain, that's so dated. It actually apparently we have many problems with our environment, but apparently acid rain in America, not as big a problem now. I hate to say that because I feel like somebody's going to say, no, look at this news. You were just reading bad news stories. This one says it's just as bad now, but apparently not.
Well, that kind of, because back in the day, like when in the 90s and in the early aughts, you did still have like, if there was going to be an environmental disaster, it was going to be something, you know, it wouldn't be great, but you could live with it. Like acid rain, it would suck, but you could live with it. Like sometimes it would stop or you would find like we would get new umbrellas that would work with it, all this. But like now, it's so like overwhelming. Like you literally can't look past anything but constant flooding. Like, that is the nightmare scenario. It's just like everything flooded out. Like you can't go as small as acid rain. Acid rain would actually be a blessing if that's all we were looking forward to.
And so the rainy day has come again. It's melting squirrels. The way Marty says, better stay inside, at least until the squirrels stop melting. They briefly watch a parody of Blind Date.
Yeah, I had to look this up because I was a viewer of these dating shows. The person I was dating at the time was into them. It wasn't me, but it brought me back to the days of Blind Date, Elimidate, and of course, Shipmates with that charming man, Chris Hardwick, one of the future Dukes of podcasting. Speaking of me, too. Anyhow, there was like along with like the judge show boom, there was also a dating show boom of this era. And because nothing can ever die, this show came back in 2019 without Roger Lodge, I will say.
Boo.
Yeah.
Oh boy.
It's gotta get Roger Lodge. Now, I of all of those, I watch Blind Date the most because I hate to admit, as it is a trashy show, but there is something about the pop-up video jokes on the people that entertained me.
That just hit my brain. I was like, oh, didn't they do like thought bubbles and, you know, clip art and stuff to kind of dress up these dead-eyed losers dating each other?
Yes. My favorites were when the woman like starts stirring her straw and the psychiatrist pop-up thing would say she's thinking about how his dick probably sucks or whatever. Like he's no good at bed.
I remember the last one I remember watching was the one where it was a nerds and models being paired up. And like they were all it wasn't the hottie and the naughty, but it was something like that. And
oh yeah, like Date the Geek or something, or yeah, like some, Geek Date. Yeah.
Yeah, Geek Date. That's I forget the name of it, but the funniest thing about it was like all these guys were like objectively handsome. They just had glasses on. That was the whole, like literally they just did the Rachel Lee Cook thing except for with guys. And like I'm sure there was one or two duds that I'm forgetting, but like I remember most of them like, yeah, of course anybody would want to date that. Or what are you talking about?
Well, Mo would not be on Fuckboy Island. That's one of the newer dating shows.
Love is Blind, like, maybe that voice he might be able to get something.
You know, also though, that the line of him saying it was nice and her replying he smelled like puke, I feel like there's a darker joke they changed that line to. I don't know. I wonder if Al Jean curtailed some of the roofie jokes that they had previously done with Mo. And because if I'm in season 12 mindset and I'm pitching Mo goes on a date joke, you either say he's a stalker or he has Rufinol.
I mean we talked about it when we did the episode, but the Paul Bunyan parody has Mo carrying away a giant roofie to go to the barn dance.
But the antenna then melts. They have no TV. A fun bit of Homer going outside to scream and getting rained on, going back in and seeing the TV's broken and going in screaming more, in and out, screaming a bunch. Then Marge is saying, stop screaming, Homer. Quit trying to control me. And boy, this was a runner, though. The rainy day fun. How many times have we watched them look at a pile of board games?
Like, that's true. Or like craft kits.
Yeah, either craft kits, board games, all the stuff. Like, it's like the fifth time, it feels like.
Also, a simpler time. This was the dawn of theme Monopoly, because before this, everyone was making their own illegal theme monopolies. I remember, like, a kiosk at the mall. It's like, if do you like a sports team? We have our own Monopoly based on that sports team. Then Monopoly was like, hey, we could do Rick and Morty Monopoly. We could do Stranger Things Monopoly that gives away the entire show.
Yes. That's right. Yeah.
There's a spoiler in the Monopoly version of Stranger Things.
Oh, that's so fun. I forgot that. Right.
Yes.
Oh, man. I would have loved. God. Was it just sports teams? Like, did they have like a Cheers Monopoly, or like, was it just those kinds of brands?
Oh, well, the bootlegs would be. Yeah. I remember in my area, there was Jaguarsopoly.
Yeah.
The Simpsons had a Monopoly by the time this joke came out. They had their own.
I bought it this year. I still have my 2002 Simpsons Monopoly set.
Oh, that's awesome.
Because it's very easy. It's very flat, easy to move around. But they made another one. There's like another edition.
There's a Treehouse of Horror version. Yeah.
Oh, and Jesus.
But when I looked, I've never played it, but when I looked at the board of it, my favorite thing is that all the railroads are monorails, and the monorails are Shelbyville, Ogdenville, and North Haverbrook, along with the Springfield monorail, which that's pretty
nice.
Fun.
That's nice. I like that.
We better stay inside, at least until the squirrels stop melting.
No problem. There's plenty of activities inside.
Now let's see how our blind dates liked each other.
Oh, I really felt there was a connection, and I would definitely go out with her again.
He smelled like puke!
The TV! Oh!
Oh! Oh! Oh! Oh! Oh! Oh!
Stop screaming, Homer.
Quit trying to control me.
We don't need TV to have family fun. Why don't we play Monopoly?
Which version? We've got Star Wars Monopoly, Rasta Monopoly, Gallipolopoly, Edna Krabopoly.
Let's stick to original Monopoly. The game is crazy enough as it is. How can an iron be a landlord?
Also, it seems Gallipolopoly, that's a reference to World War I. Edna Krabopoly seems like she's selling her own sexy version of it, which, but though also the Sopranos has a perfect episode about this too. It's the season 6B premiere called Sopranos Home Movies. Monopoly does tear families apart. Like, it is made to cause fights. Like, it's that's what it's for.
My family stopped playing it because I always won.
Ah, that I see.
I think it's because I was a kid and my parents would drink beer while we played. the thinking process has slowed down a bit. Mm. But I will say the crustiest joke in this episode is using the phrase Mon to make a Jamaica joke. Monopoly.
Yeah.
Oh, it's so sweet. Crusty.
Yeah. But, you know, in my family, the fights would usually be about Mom making a deal with me or my brother over the other one, and we're like, oh, why'd you pick his deal? She's like, well, he's got the property I want or whatever. And then, oh man, and then like the cultural divide, I never went through the divide of like, well, we say grace this way in this house, but if you go to somebody else's house, like, well, yeah, if you land on free parking, you get the taxes collected. And somebody else goes, that's not in the rule book. You're like, well, it's house rules. Like, people have difference of opinion on that.
I mean, the Uno was the only thing that broke the icy silence in my house. Monopoly was not one, but I definitely witnessed my father getting more heated than anybody should be over a particularly harrowing session of Jenga.
Oh, wow.
Oh, man.
Was very intense into like how you're supposed to pick out each block, and people were not listening to him, and he got into somebody's face about it. And that's my main memory of dad and board games.
Wow, man. You know, I think the worst fight my family ever had was over Risk, because it was like twice as long as Monopoly, and it involved even more like deals and anger. I definitely stormed off from a Risk game once my brother took my last territory. But yeah, these Monopoly gags here, also a little, in Homer Defined, they also had a joke about Maggie eating Monopoly pizza.
That's true. We just did that. Except in that episode, there were hotels. This one, they're all houses. So a different joke.
Yeah.
Now, this may shock you, but they're constantly cycling in new pieces. There are certain things that were never part of our childhoods of playing Monopoly, which is like the cannon piece. There was never a cannon.
No.
That was retired in 1946.
Huh.
The iron longer exists. It was retired in 2013.
Oh, wow.
So an iron can no longer be a landlord.
Wow. Oh, man.
Other famous pieces retired. Thimble and Boot retired in 2017. Get out of here.
That's bullshit.
We used to be a proper country.
Yes.
Yeah.
Don't forget what they took from us.
That little tiny metal thimble.
The only things that the game started with that have been retained are the top hat, the battleship, and the race car.
Yeah, they're the sexiest ones. Of course, they're staying. Is the Monopoly Man still there?
He's still there. They kind of sex him up a bit sometimes, though.
Ooh, okay.
But the new pieces are a cat, a T-Rex, a penguin, and a rubber ducky.
Oh, God. I mean, look, I'm sure that entertains the kiddies now, but I liked that the pieces looked old because it's a game from like the 20s. Part of the appeal of it.
One of the pieces was a howitzer, like a cannon.
Wow. That is pretty crazy.
I'm not a father, so I don't know about kids with penguins, but like, was that just like right after March of the Penguins and they were like, kids love penguins, let's put out a penguin. I never think of them as specifically, or like Happy Feet. I don't after that wave, I didn't think of penguins as particularly popular, I guess.
These were 2017 pieces.
Oh,
so
Jesus. Yeah, that doesn't matter.
I imagine there'll be a Minion in there at some point.
Yes, of course.
I mean, that's Minionopoly. That's
it already exists.
Or Despicableopoly.
Yeah, Despicableopoly,
Yeah.
I'm sure there's that, and there's also like Gruopoly with the Steve Carell character.
Oh, gosh.
Isagepolopoly. But there's one of my favorite jokes in this is the thing where I noted in playing Monopoly as well as somebody counts your spaces before you do and they know where you're going to end up. But the idea that Homer rolls a three and he doesn't instantly count three and he's like, Bart just laughs because he knows where he's landing. And Homer goes, we'll see about that. 1, 2, 3. That's a good joke. Which, though Bart's obviously cheating, you're only allowed 4 hotels up to that much on there. You get 4 houses, house turns into a hotel, and then up to 4 hotels. And that's it. You can't have more than that.
Maybe the Simpsons house rules is like, just put as much real estate as you can on. Maybe they're it's free market.
I hate those. House rules are evil, but...
they're evil.
Evil! Evil! But yes, the trouble begins in the Simpsons household here.
You're a little light here, Dad.
I'm good for the rest, you know I am.
Well, I'd like to trust you, Homer, but you've been in jail 3 times.
They told me it would be like this on the outside.
These hotels are made of Legos. Bart, you're cheating.
Lisa, it was probably an accident.
Oh, sure. You take his side just because he bought you that house on St. James Place.
Who else is going to take care of her? Dad?
Why, you little...
Stop fighting.
Mom, that's not how you pry them apart.
I've been prying them apart since before you were born.
Now, Henry, you're talking about house rules. I think this 4 hotels on 1 space, it was the Gilbert house rule.
Oh, wait. You know, I'm just misremembering. It's only 1 hotel,
only 1.
Right?
Yeah, there's only 12
houses
in the set.
Hotel. No, we didn't do 4 hotels. Okay. Thank you for fact checking that.
I know a commenter would have.
Well, how'd you guys deal with, I mean, did you guys do the free parking deal of if you land on free parking, you get the money that people pay from jail and taxes?
I think I found out about that like at another house.
Oh, man.
But I never brought it back home because I didn't like it.
That sounds like a sleepover rule.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We did that every... me and my mom played Monopoly quite a bit, and everywhere we went, free parking, you got the money.
Okay. Wow, man. See, that's a different... This is like Catholic versus Protestant upbringing. Here, though I'm on Lisa's side here. Bart is clearly cheating, and Marge saying it was an accident. Like, no, it is not an accident, Marge. You know this. Like, but
she got a free house out of it.
And Marge is so used to the strangling that they're not mad that Bart is strangling, that Homer is strangling Bart, just that Lisa is nagging Marge to strangle, to break it up the right way. So then Maggie very cutely presses the quick call to the police for the strangle button. And this gets, it cuts to Wiggum. He's training everybody for the Nutcracker Ballet, which I love his like very snippiness about it. It's cute too. And
then, it's a good mislead because you think it's going to cut to the Simpsons.
Oh, yes.
Being in a police lineup.
But instead, it's him telling guys that they're not even trying. He also outs a guy as a snitch who's probably murdered right after he leaves the room. They chalk it up to another case of Monopoly-related violence as tears apart all families.
Case of Monopoly-related violence, Chief.
How do those Parker brothers sleep at night?
We better send in the Negotiabot.
I am Brenda. I am programmed to talk in a calm and constructive manner.
Destroy! Destroy!
Hey, this is Taffy!
Police brutality!
And chew-tality!
Nice work, Brenda. I'll take it from here.
No way. This is my collar.
Too bad real women don't come with these, huh?
You got that right.
Quiet, you. That counts as your phone call.
That scene feels like it was written backwards from the joke chutality. Like, how do we get to chutality?
Yeah. Well, also the Negotiabot is a woman to write backwards for the joke of switching the off switch on a woman. And that's a real cake and eat it too, because I feel like they should have people roll their eyes at his lame old sexist joke, but instead everybody's like, ha, that's pretty funny. You're right, man. Yeah.
Feeling like get out of here. And like, I honestly think rather than putting money into Bearcats, we should be making more Brendas. We have people aren't eating as much taffy anymore anyway. We have a short, you can just use all the old taffy and get this going. And I think this would be much more appropriate.
I love Tress's performance as Brenda of like, destroy, like, she's that's great. Oh, yeah. Man. You know, the joke of the family being arrested has happened so many times, but I feel like this is also Gene saying, like, yeah, this is how awful the family has gotten. They need to be arrested routinely. And I think Gene, too, it makes sense that he would be, like, of the opinion that he needs to create a character to finally ask him, what the fuck happened to this family? Why are you so awful now?
And he doesn't really address the child abuse, though.
No.
Which is a major issue in this family.
Yeah, I feel like an actual Gabriel would say, well, you can't strangle your son. That's first off. And then you're under arrest, sir.
But at the very least, you have to ask him if you can strangle him. Then maybe, but at the very least.
So we come back with the headline, Simpsons arrested in family riot, even Maggie. And they're all in jail. Marge says many times this season, this is their new low. That was the joke in the last episode. Marge says, this is the worst thing you've ever done, which she says in this episode.
They should have like changed that because it literally just happened.
Yeah. Also, to let you know that Al Jean's back in charge, a Harvard man's back in charge, a joke about Ivy League colleges. Because Lisa is worried she's not going to get into an Ivy League school now. And then the joke is settling for Stanford, which obviously if you went to Harvard and had Stanford as your safety school, you get that joke. All the rest of us do not.
No.
It's not for us.
Most of us would be pretty happy to get into Stanford.
Oh, absolutely. I went to a crappy state school.
Yeah. You know, Bill Oakley and Josh Weinstein, they had that Harvard-Stanford split. Oakley got into Harvard, Weinstein into Stanford. Though Weinstein still, on his summer vacations at Stanford, wrote for the Harvard Lampoon, so he technically is a Harvard Lampooner as well.
And if you're curious about Stanford, I'm reading that over 4 years, a Stanford education would theoretically cost about $298,000. But many students do not end up paying that much. So, you know what? Maybe only $250,000.
Hey, yeah. Okay.
Not bad.
If you skip the meal plan, then maybe you can get out with under $250,000.
Well, and hey, if you're lucky enough to have like a relative that lives nearby, you can just stay with them. Easy. No, not even paying rent. So, yes, this is when in comes Gabriel, our guest. I'll play his clip first.
Hello, I'm Gabriel.
A heavenly choir! You must be an angel.
No, that's my pager. I'm a social worker. I'm here to help you stop fighting and become a family again.
No, you are an angel. Like Denzel Washington in The Preacher's Wife, or Will Smith in Bagger Vance, or Slimer in Ghostbusters.
Sir, we know you're not an angel. My husband sees too many movies.
Don't blame me. Blame Tinseltown in its second golden age. May it never end.
You know, Bob, I think you're right that they did want Morgan Freeman and Delroy Lindo as their secondary, which is, I think this design is Morgan Freeman.
It really feels like it now that, since Chris mentioned it.
Oh, it's Chris, yes.
Chris mentioned that it feels like it looks like somebody else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it struck me. And also, the weirdest thing to me is the line about that, oh, that's just my pager. Like, clearly, if you are, and I know, like, at this point, like, character continuity is very low on the list of things that matter. But, like, if you have that pager, you are into angels and you are into religious shit. And just, like, be like, oh, no, that was just my pager sound. I just said, and, like, it's a funny enough joke, I guess. But, yeah, back to your point, like, as soon as he walks in and talks like this, I'm like, wait a minute. Well, isn't this like right around Bruce Almighty? Like, Bruce Almighty is like 2003, I think.
Yes. Yeah. Well, let's talk about this, because this certainly is them commenting on a thing that was in the news then in 2001 when they wrote this. So obviously this trope existed far back in history, but in February of 2001, Spike Lee was doing an event where he was speaking, and he was talking about a thing that was bothering him in recent films, in particular The Legend of Bagger Vance, The Green Mile, The Family Man, and What Dreams May Come. He named those four specifically. And he called it the magical black person, let's just say. But it is, as he defines it, quote, how is it that black people have these powers, but they use them for the benefit of white people? And in general, it is the magical black person's trope of a character like the ones in all of those movies. Homer names one of them, and I guess technically Preacher's Wife, but because it's a mainly black cast, I don't think it counts as that, because he's not helping white people. But yeah, it was this general point about a racist trope in films that people were noting of, like, well, see, you only have one black person in your entire cast, but since you make them like God, basically, in the case of Bruce Almighty even, well, then it couldn't be racist because they're making him the most pure person in the world, you know?
Well, yeah. I mean, Bruce Almighty was bringing it all the way back around, because I think the origin of that trope, you could probably go way back and find a lot of it. But like the thing that modern, like as far as the modern understanding of it is, I think it's driving Miss Daisy and Morgan Freeman being in that and being able to take all the I mean, if you watch that movie again, he takes some shit. Like, you watch our movies, you could not make at whatever she's doing in that movie. You could not allow that to happen now. And Bruce Almighty is kind of like the, you take them from like, yeah, like, no, it's no longer a joke. They are God. They literally are God, and they're going to give the godlike powers to Jim Carrey, and then they're going to shy away, I guess, for the rest of the movie, essentially.
I think it has, thanks to critiques like Spike Lee's getting more mainstream, and, you know, the credit to The Simpsons, they are making fun of it here, too, it definitely appears less. And I was trying to think of the last, like, major film that you could call an example of that. Certainly The Green Book is a bit of that. Like,
there's a really, it, thank God, did not get a lot of press, and it made me so sad, but Eddie Murphy did one of these not too long ago.
Really?
Called Mr. Church. It is horrible, and I'm a Eddie Murphy diehard. I watched the whole damn thing, and I don't even want to talk about it beyond saying that it exists. I think it really is one of those things that I think that was like the last, like, they offered Eddie Murphy God knows how much money, and they're like, this movie is not made anymore until Green Book is made. Now, who knows? Maybe it is going to be made again, but. Yeah, I feel like it was a last ditch effort for him to get an award after the Dreamgirls fiasco.
Got Norbited.
Yeah, everybody thought he was going to win for Dreamgirls, and it just didn't happen.
It's because Norbit was coming out right before. Yeah. It reminded people like, oh, this guy is garbage. Like, why we can't give this guy an Oscar? I think he should have won for Dreamgirls. I thought he was great in Dreamgirls.
Fantastic. I enjoy the mention of Slimer, but I bet kids these days are saying, don't they mean Muncher, my favorite character?
Oh, Bob, please.
You know, Delroy Lindo, as far as his typecasting, usually it's just he's like a cop or an admiral or a gangster. Like that often is played, that's what he gets typecast as.
Yeah.
Two of my favorite roles of his, he's a gangster in Malcolm X and Get Shorty. Like he's so good in both of those. In Malcolm X, he is this, you know, scary but tragic tale of like this guy who is running numbers for the whole, of Harlem and is making all this money. But he's actually like a super genius who could have been, Malcolm X makes a point of like this guy could have been a Nobel Prize winner in science the way he was able to memorize numbers. But there was no chance for him. Like the system shoved him into this corner and made him die in a gutter somewhere.
His career is really interesting. He started appearing in TV movies in the late 70s, and then he disappeared for a decade just to do theater throughout the 80s. And then from 1990 on, where he's back in TV and movies again. Yeah. And the year before this, he was in The One. He was in Heist, and he was also in The Last Castle. He was not in any movies that came out into the year 2002, though.
Okay.
I think he was probably filming The Core this year, very early. This year was probably what he was doing. The Core, a horrible movie.
You guys covered that movie, right?
We did. We just actually covered The Last Castle not too long ago. And it's amazing. That movie is just him essentially like cucking James Gandolfini. Like, he just comes in to be like, James Gandolfini, you are fucking this prison up. I don't know what I'm going to do with you. I'll give you one more try. And then Robert Redford, of course, fucks him up again. But this was just a time when he was doing all these kinds of movies. Like, he's in two Jet Li movies in like a year. It's Romeo Must Die and The One.
That's right.
They must have been buddies, which is pretty cool. Honestly, if you get to be friends with Jet Li.
I was trying to think of Lindo and his filmography, if he had been part of this trope or been cast in the specific trope. And the closest I could find is the film Life Less Ordinary, where he does play an angel. But it's him and Holly Hunter, and they're kind of like bumbling dopes tasked with making two people fall in love. So yes, he is a magically powered black man who is doing things for the benefit of a white person, or two white people. So I do suppose it is kind of that trope. And he, I think, is the only black man in the film who has any part of notice. But it's been a while since I've seen that movie.
That movie's not very, I mean, I remember, yeah, they're bumbling angels is the whole point. But he definitely had two hugely questionable performances. The one in Congo, where he's like their handler, and he's doing this accent that I don't want to talk about. And the same thing in The Devil's Advocate, where he's like, he's like a guy who's like sacrificing goats to his god, and Al Pacino the devil is like, no, let him do what he's doing.
Oh, wow, man. I forgot that part.
It's rough stuff. But like, as you said, like Get Shorty, that's when I think he takes off. And then like something like Defy Bloods, which I will be one of the only times I actually was like hurt by somebody not getting a nomination by the Oscars. That to me is one of the best performances of the last few decades. Is him in that movie.
No, Spike Lee uses him well. And yeah, I don't. Nope. It's also like on a certain level, especially for parts over 20 years ago, I don't want to blame the actors too much if their characters like were part of a stereotype, because it's like you took what you could get, you know? Yeah. Like they weren't making the movies, they're just getting cast in them. Like,
absolutely. Yeah.
So yes, then this feels definitely like Al Jean taking accounting of the entire series of like, okay, how fucked up is the whole family? We need to bring an outsider in here who then can explain to them, this family's fucked up, guys. Which he does first by talking to Lisa and Marge.
In a difficult case like this, I like to observe each family member individually.
Well, my room is my sanctuary. My family knows that and respects that.
I got sprayed by a skunk. Let me rub it off in your sweaters.
Just 10 more years. Just 10 more years. Just 10 more years.
Attention, everyone. This is Gabriel, my personal social worker. He has to be here. I'm just that nuts.
Right. How come you get a social worker? I'm the one with stigmata.
Weird.
Thank you, Marge. You sure do love cooking.
Food keeps my family happy. So I make a few practice dinners before showtime. 'cause at 6 o'clock, we go live.
That's the best joke in the, in the episode.
Yeah.
Another insane Marge joke.
that Marge bakes a practice dinner that she must just throw away beforehand. I mean, I love the drawing. Matt Nastic and his team do a great job on this. The crazy smile on Marge's face, like, that's so good. And yeah, also that Bart, it's just so weird. Milhouse has stigmata. Out of all things,
I enjoy the stigmata has Foley. You can hear the blood coming out of it.
That is.
I was wondering because it's a weird joke because all the other ones are about like how fucked up the kids are, and like Bart is just like, yeah, he has to pay attention to me, and then here's Milhouse doing this weird thing, and I'm just okay. You're absolutely right. The Marge scene, to me, part of me wonders if those practice dinners are like midnight snacks for Homer, like, because you know he's getting up and he's not always eating the Kraft singles all the way through. Sometimes he just needs like an early take on a roast beef.
That's actually the 1 a.m. lasagna she leaves for Homer that he eats every night. Yeah. But Gabriel's discomfort at it is great, too. I like that. And then we get, honestly, this is kind of a sequel scene to Homer with Mulder and Scully in the bar, too. I got to say.
This episode also reminds me of another one he co-wrote, which is the Sherry Bobbins one, where it's a stranger who comes to the house and kind of investigates how terrible everyone is.
Who also denies that they're a magical stranger, too.
Yes.
But she actually is. Yeah. You know what? They don't make Delroy Lindo sing. That's the one.
A little bit.
No, actually, they do make him sing. You're right. Yeah.
It's good he didn't sing more.
It's fun. It's fun. But yes, I actually, again, if you view this as how Al Jean views what they've done to the characters, this scene of Homer, I think, really sums up where Homer is at after the Scully years.
Okay, Gabriel, this is a bar. It's where I go to drink alcohol, which is the mortal equivalent of your ambrosia.
Homer, I am not an angel.
Well, not with that temper. Look, the thing about my family is there's five of us. Marge, Bart, Girl Bart, the one who doesn't talk, and the fat guy. Oh, I loathe him.
Oh. So Gabriel watch Homer get blackout drunk, and then as Homer recounts that he can't remember the names of any kid that isn't named Bart, Homer then reveals that the person he hates most is himself, who is the worst person in the family. Which, yeah, again, the Gabriel's diagnosis should just be, you're an alcoholic destroying your family. You need to stop drinking, and then we can fix other things first after that, Homer. But yes, instead, he's got an arts and crafts project. The characters move to a very beautiful drawing of a park, and which Homer thinks is heaven. He slowly gives out his diagnosis as Bart just wants attention, including put on a beard of bees.
They chose him.
I love it. It's like, cut that out. Like Lindo, like screaming, like, cut that out. It's funny.
Marge, you medicate your family with food. Bart, you'll do anything for attention. Cut that out!
They chose me.
Homer, your problem is quite simple. You're a drunken, childish buffoon.
Which is society's fault because...
It's your fault, Homer. But I've got an exercise that will help all of you break out of the roles you're stuck in. Who feels like lunch?
Me!
Right here.
Oh, me too.
Good. I hung it on the top of that tree.
But how are we supposed to get it?
You'll just have to cooperate.
Cooperate? Well, this is one family that doesn't swing that way.
Are you sure? I made roast beef sandwiches, one falafel.
Thank you.
And plenty of beer.
Give me that beer!
He says he actually doesn't have a note for Lisa. I think he just agrees with her. But he tells Marge that she, medicates a family with food. And then his thing of Homer, like, you're a drunken, childish buffoon. Which is society's fault because it's your fault, Homer. Just boom. But he gives them a mission to get their get their lunch out of a backpack, which has beer in it, too. And I have to say, when Homer grabs him violently and then runs over a tree again, it's like, OK, arrest this man, like or commit him.
Send him to rehab.
This is your problem right here.
Get the FBI involved at this point, honestly, just to make sure this person is really put put away. Also, I have to question, like, this guy's an alcoholic. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to trap him with the promise of beer. The through line doesn't make total sense to me. Although what is this? I mean, I guess we're going to get to the joke, but like, have they laid down this alternate type of beer, this non-Duff beer that they talk about here?
So Bat's beer is real.
It's real. Yeah. It's a Midwestern beer. I don't think I've seen it since I left Ohio, and it wasn't even that common, but it was one of those breweries that was like around in the days of Pabst, you know, one of those ancient German breweries that got bought a million times. I think like Miller owns them or something like that, or Anheuser-Busch, but it's a real beer known for being cheap. I guess so bad Homer won't drink it.
Well, I mean, I guess that's what, I mean, like, yeah, something had to die so Extra Gold and Stroh's could really rise up. That makes sense.
Yeah, it's one of those beers like Schlitz or Straub. It's just like these weird names that like your grandpa drank or something.
They all taste like tortilla chips. It's all.
Yeah.
If you're going to a party and want to be cheap, you're like, guys, I brought a 12 pack, but it's this. It's Schlitz. Yeah. Until researching this time, I'd always just thought it was like Homer missaying Pabst, because when I think like shitty beer, I think Pabst Blue Ribbon.
Hey, Pabst is the king of shitty beer.
Okay,
take it back.
If you had in front of me a Pabst or a Tecate, I'd say give me that Tecate. Mm. That's what.
Hey,
I'd
me
say.
Too.
Yeah.
But Homer even nearly runs over Gabriel, then knocks over the tree, which nearly crushes Gabriel, which then pulls him down into a ravine, and Gabriel is very nice about this. He's like, no, I'm okay, which is like, wait, no, you're not okay. Like, you're
it's a ravine full of wolves and cougars who have teamed up.
I love that. Yes. Yeah.
Once again, the Simpsons have found themselves versus a ravine. They always get stuck with these ravines.
I also love when the Simpsons get in a huddle together. Homer, in true jerk-ass form, is just like, his plan is, we're going to abandon him here and he dies and we never talk about it again.
As a family.
He didn't want it that way.
And then he makes Lisa stage whisper.
Yeah. I also love that Lisa's like, we got to break our old patterns, meaning that Homer has done this before of like, well, just leave the person to die. We'll be good. Just never talk about it.
I mean, those kids have definitely had to bury a lot of things at this point. 13 seasons in, they're already packed to the gills.
And yeah, the drawing of the cougars and wolves huddled together is very funny too. I like that. Which and also Marge tripping and injuring her driving ankle. Like, what a silly excuse for Bart to drive the car. Also, Marge is standing in the very next shot. Like, you know,
hey, it's not a standing ankle.
Oh, sure. Okay. Yeah.
Or a running ankle. But,
so they pull them out, though the roast beef sandwiches fall out, and as is the falafel sandwich, which gets eaten by them, and Homer says the roast beef is making them stronger, and the falafel is making them angrier. Because, of course, vegan food is bad, and you wouldn't want to eat it, and it tastes bad. Mm-hmm. That's the classic joke.
Falafel's disgusting. Of course, everybody knows this. It's not a delicious treat that everybody likes. It's terrible, and it's...
Mm-hmm. And that area comes from, isn't it a little iffy?
Yes, yeah,
yes.
Exactly.
Yes, yeah. It is indeed. And,
you know, now Disneyland sells falafel. They'd put it in stuff, but
is that because it was like in an Avengers movie?
Yes.
Okay, I thought so.
Yes, yeah. It's shawarma as a joke. It became a food in Disneyland thanks to that one ad lib by Robert Downey Jr. as so many years ago.
Famous shawarma and falafel from California. Yes, California. Yep, yeah. Don't look too much farther into that, California.
But yes, Homer refuses to throw out the beer until he realizes it's Blatt's, which they even make sure to show you the logo right up front just to be like, yes, we're making fun of this real logo. Here it is. This sucks. So they save his life. And again, Gabriel, very, you know, forgiving. He actually, you would think nearly killing him would count as a fail, but he actually gives him a pass on it.
It is a great joke that they're almost killed by the wolves and cougars, but when Homer sees that they enjoy beer, he goes, hey, they're all right.
Yes, that's a great line. It's like he becomes Don Rickles there. For a second. Hey, they're all right. Yeah. So it seems like everything is fine as they drive home.
We are family.
Our bitter fights are now history.
We are family.
Wolves and cougars ate our roast beef.
Well, I think you all did great. You broke out of your normal roles to accomplish something as a family. I've really earned my wings.
I knew it.
No, I mean this CD. The best of wings. Band on the Run.
You know, we've been through some 280 adventures together, but our bond has never been stronger.
Yep, our family is as functional as all get out.
Could this be the end of our series of events?
Can I help you?
Yeah, I'm looking for Homer Simpson.
Oh, it's the woman I married in Vegas!
Homer, you're a bad man, and your seed should be wiped from the earth. No offense, children.
Well, you really tell his recording in there in that clip, actually.
Yeah, yeah.
But
that's a bite to it.
I love that Gabriel physically leaves the episode. Like, he will not return. He's done with them.
Which, this is actually episode 276.
Yes, yeah.
And as of this recording, 728 just aired.
Woo!
Don't tell me things like that, Bob. I really have been losing track, and I was happy to have lost track. I that is the sucky thing about watching episodes like this, and Lisa has a line like, you know, could this be the end of the series? I'm like, please, oh please, if only, like, please.
It's an interesting joke for LG to make in his first episode back as showrunner, just like reflecting on, like, this is how long this has been going on.
Yep. Yeah. I feel like they intentionally had her say some 280 because she knew, like, the fans at home know this is 276, not 280, I guess, or the super fans. But I suppose it fits. But, man, they paid for a wing song just to get that silly joke. They actually just paid for Band on the Run. That couldn't have been cheap. Yeah.
No, I didn't think so.
But Vegas wives have returned, which, again, this is Gene dealing with something he didn't like from the Scully years, which is just that Homer and Ned married two floozies in Vegas, as Homer called them, and left them there. And then they went like, well, we're going to get with these other guys. They basically thought they were going to marry Siegfried and Roy, which, you know, wasn't going to go too far for them. But I have to point out right up front here, guys, they were cocktail waitresses in their first episode. They were not sex workers. They were not and they weren't written this trashy. Like, they were not, they're not they make jokes about their, like, weight and stuff, and obviously cocktail waitresses in Vegas, they are gonna be a little judgy of them as trashy, but they're not sex workers or whores, or as they would have said back then. Like, I don't like that joke. I gotta say, I don't like that.
No, I think they're, I mean, in the original episode, they're much more confident. They're, like, self-assured. They know who they are. That's the character you get the sense of when they're introduced, at least. And in here, I mean, what, I don't know what the thought process is behind, like, oh, there was some random storyline from The Simpsons, which I imagine there is, like, several dozen hundreds. I mean, but, like, why was this the one that stuck out to him that, like, I need this to be rectified?
Yeah,
I don't get it.
And it's so evocative of where humor was at this point. It's an ugly time for all of us, but this is just evocative of the gross out, sexist, slut shaming humor that was very, very popular in the early 2000s.
Very much so. Yes. Yeah. It's sucky. And I feel like it's shocking that this episode is actually meaner towards women than the original Vegas one was, Viva Ned Flanders, which was in the supposedly dirtier Scully years. Like, Homer's a bigger asshole in that episode, but they're meaner to the women in this episode. Absolutely they are.
100%.
Yeah. I think, too, they wanted to show, I think it was important for Gene to bring them back so they showed that Homer did not physically cheat on Marge. Like, he even kissed Ned at the nuptials.
No mouth whoopee. Although, if you go back to the original wedding tape from that episode, the wives kissed them. They didn't reuse the same footage. They made new footage in which Ned and Homer kiss each other.
So it retcons it to he didn't kiss her, even though they did.
Yeah, wow. They did commit mouth whoopee.
I don't like that.
No, I mean, this, and also, like, they're just written as, like, straight up gold diggers as Amber and Ginger move into their respective houses.
You and Ned married a couple of floozies?
Marge, I'm sorry, but it wasn't my fault. Liquor's drunkened me.
If I had known there were loose women in Las Vegas, I would never have let you go.
Look, I did marry her, but I abandoned her. Amber, tell her how I abandoned you.
This is the worst thing you've ever done.
Well, Ginger, sure is neat that you managed to hunt me down.
Where's the bed?
Oh, Lord, I know my new wife is a little more peppermint than you're used to, but I know you'd want me to honor my sacred vows, so I will.
Hey, stud, where do you keep your wet ones? I need a shower.
Oh, we've got a real shower upstairs.
Upstairs? I hit the jackpot!
You know, if I lived in a two-story house, I'd feel I hit the jackpot, too. You know?
Yeah,
I'm with her.
These uppity comedy writers and their two stories.
Yeah.
Look, having just moved into one, I could tell you it's a dream. It's really something else.
Man, jealous. And
you get that extra cardio during the day, too?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes. There's one secret deleted scene on the DVD, actually, where when Marge admonishes Homer about going to Vegas, Amber says, yeah, he abandoned me, but this ring drew me back to him. And she's like showing off a fancy engagement ring, except when Marge looked at it, she says, that's 24 karat gold dink. And there's a heart-shaped diamondello in the center of it. So... it's a good joke about fake diamonds. I like that.
But, yeah, I would have preferred that to a lot of the jokes that are in this, honestly.
Me too.
And Ginger is so much trashier than before. I wish, though, she had stayed. It's fun. I at least think they identify that they have something to go with of the now Maud-free widow Ned having a new wife that he has to be like, well, I do have one wife now, so I may as well just keep her here and make it, see if I can make it work.
I just feel kind of bad for these women, and they're like incredibly desperate lives they live. That's indicated in all the jokes about them.
Yes, yeah. They're just like, no, I'm going to be a squatter in this house now. I have nowhere else to go. This is better than anything else going on in my life.
Yeah, they drove all the way from fucking Nevada to on a long shot that they'd be able to make this work. That's really bleak.
And so this is when Homer tries to talk more with Marge. We've said it before, but this is a real era of blank, eh? And Homer comes in the room saying, sitting on the bed, eh? but Homer makes a very Clinton-era joke about mouth whoopee to let you know that he did not have sex. He did not have sexual relations with this woman. But Homer thinks he's got a fix.
Sitting on the bed, eh?
Get out, Homer.
Look, I married her, but that is as far as we went. We never, ever made whoopee or even mouth whoopee.
Homer, I don't know if I can ever forgive you. Please go away.
Fair enough, but I'm going to come back with the greatest gift a husband can give his wife, an annulment from his secret wife.
Mr. Simpson, under Nevada law, bigamy, or Mormon hold'em, is perfectly legal. Both marriages stand.
But I only love Marge.
I hereby order you to take care of both of your wives. Bailiff, ring him.
Oh.
It's Constance Harr making a second appearance this season. I think they saw her as their new Lionel Hutz, I think.
Yeah, this episode loves women. A double marriage is like a double jail sentence.
Yes, yes, yep. Though also bigamy has not been legal in Nevada for a very long time, ever since America outlawed it in pretty much every state except Utah, and then Utah after that too. Bigamy is not legal. So that's just them being silly. They're like, you know what? Bigamy is legal in Nevada, so your marriage stands. It's like, what? That's not how that works. I like that it's Constance just going like, ah, fuck you, Homer. Like, you're I'm gonna send you to more marriage.
This is I'm just in free fall at this point. I'm like, where is this episode going? What is happening? Just please find me an out. Like, I once it switches from the Delroy Lindo to the old Las Vegas wives, I'm just like, okay, you guys are just going with whatever. Like, whatever's going. And fine, I at least hope the jokes are good, which they mostly are not. Except for all the cigarette jokes are pretty funny, I will say.
I like jokes about smoking. Those are funny. But I mean, that, you know, Patty and Selma are just as good for that kind of gag, I think.
Yeah, it's true. But Cigarette Aficionado, the magazine, definitely gave me a big chuckle on this one.
That's true, yeah. Because they're gross, smoky women and disgusting. Yeah,
of course.
And yeah. but yes, I also love Homer saying, you know, at least trying to hide behind the census when Marge kicks him out.
It'll cause a miscount.
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 And then a very silly joke about Homer getting bitten in the ass by a chipmunk. But actually, my favorite joke in the episode is this very silly one about Marge's delivery at the end of the scene makes me chuckle.
Of all the things to ever come back and bite me in the ass, this is the worst! Please, just leave me alone.
Now, now. Mama's gonna make you a snack.
Ooh! Oh, yeah. Oh, that's good. Oh, don't stop. Oh, yeah. Faster. 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 Oh, you do that like a pro.
Oh, no. She's making him a sandwich.
Use both hands.
I noticed that Julie did say sandwich.
Yes, yeah.
As well.
That's great. But just, there's... To do such a corny, funny joke about like, oh, this sounds like sex joke, but that Marge knows exactly what it is, but it's that is what she hates about it, that it actually, she knows it's betrayal of making sandwiches, which she loves to do for Homie instead. That's just so good.
I also think use both hands is a fantastic stinger. Like, just beautiful. Beautiful.
Wouldn't you use both hands to make a sandwich? I mean, yeah.
Maybe he wants her to wield the knife like a sword, which is kind of it.
Yeah. The two-hander method on that sounds pretty spicy to me. I like that.
Hey, if you can get it.
Meanwhile, we cut back to the other disgusting woman with her caked on makeup. How piggishly.
A painted harlot.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, it's like, yeah, people fall asleep with makeup on. Give her a fucking break, man. But yeah. I do love how when she drinks the coffee and asks him to Irish it up, Irish is a swear word in their house. That's a good gag. Yeah. And then they flushed her sin sticks to hell. Smokers or jokers? Smokers or jokers? Smokers. It's a good joke about what a cult-like atmosphere they live in. At least. And honestly, Ginger's problem is she's going through detox in this moment here.
This is not the first woman Ned has scared away from her house post Maud death.
Yeah, that's
his
true.
House post Maud death.
But this time the kids are helping him with it. But you know what? He's also very supportive of her detox. They're going to hold her hair back when she vomits. You know, he wants her to get clean, but they're going to help.
They're very excited.
Then also a very gross joke about I guess it's like, oh, this woman has multiple wigs. What a gross woman. Disgusting. But I like that Bart turns down counting cards. He's like, I got my own system. I need help with that.
I mean, this is not a great episode. It's got some funny jokes in it, though, because it is all downhill. Like Chris said, it's all free fall from here. But cutting away to Moe's to make the incredibly corny two knives joke.
Yes, yes. Yeah.
I got to tell you, it's pretty terrific.
I got it here. I do love this joke.
Doesn't it bother you that you're breaking up our family?
You know, I bet you and me could be friends. I could show you how to put on makeup.
I'm 8 years old.
You could look 7. And I could teach you to count cards.
Yeah, I already got a system.
Geez, Homer, I thought someone with two wives would be happy.
No, you're thinking of someone with two knives.
I gotta tell you, this is pretty terrific. Yeah.
Yeah, the way he has the knives, he looks at him like, yeah, like he
it's
loves
just
it.
Good to see Mo happy. Yes, you know, yeah. He's found something to brighten up his day.
Dual wielding knives, it just makes him feel great. Yeah, it
certainly is a much better one than the. I really had a problem with the Britney Beers line. I was like, what? Hey, that's lazy as shit. But also, are you taking a dig at Britney Spears? Like, at this time, that seems a little weird.
I chalked it up to Marge being a bad joke writer and that but yeah, it could also just be a mean joke at the expense of Britney Spears. It could be that. Yeah. There certainly were many back then, though she had been a guest on the show and they should have been nicer to a former guest.
Yeah.
Also, we see Amber asleep in the treehouse, very uncomfortably, her head sticking out of the window or with the doorway with her cigarette in her mouth, falling asleep smoking.
That treehouse grows in size to the point where like two adults could sit inside comfortably.
Oh yeah, yeah,
you know,
yeah. Right.
The staging is always so weird.
It's a magical treehouse. Yeah, are we to suppose this is some sort of magic treehouse? And Homer then gets himself literally in the doghouse, but only about a two-thirds of the way, a third of the way, I'd say.
This is what, like, charms Marge, the fact that he got a doghouse stuck on his head, but he remained calm.
Yes. Yeah, it's...
She just smiles like, oh, Homer.
Oh, I got it. How can I say no to that guy? But I do love Homer. Another good line in this is, the sweet couple of seconds before I remember why I'm sleeping on the lawn. Like, that's a good gag.
Yes.
But Marge decides she's going to discuss the bigamy with Homer. And honestly, you know, Marge is right in the next scene when she's like, they'd be better off without Homer. I think so. Though Marge obviously would have to get a job. Like, it's a one income house. But as the plan unfolds. So do you think this would have played better if you didn't know the family was in on it? Like, their little thumbs up to each other when they leave makes it clear to the audience, like, no, Homer and Marge aren't broken up. This is all part of the plan. So it kind of deflates the whole, like, misdirect of, oh, Homer and Amber are definitely together, you know?
Like, I think you're definitely going with, it's better if it's just Homer, because then maybe I can see the joke being like, Marge finds out at the very end is like, now this is the worst thing I've ever done, and make it a three, and like that the joke actually builds to that thing. But like, the fact that there are, like, you just have made this family, like, you wanted it to refocus on the family, you refocused on them being demented as shit, like, criminals.
Yeah, I don't think I would have bought the fact that Homer's leaving Marge finally, but I don't like the entire family's in on this felony they're committing.
Yeah. Now, okay, as a parody, I do, everything after this is difficult to talk about now. It's certainly problematic. I want to say that I do see this as The Simpsons doing a classic parody of bad sitcom writing, and I get their intent, because in a bad sitcom where it'd be like on a Full House, they'd be like, all right, stage one or two of our wacky madcap plan, and as Amber will say later, their wacky madcap plan was get a woman blackout drunk. There was no more to that plan than that, other than get her drunk. Like, but they're treating it like it is a silly, wacky plan from a sitcom.
I mean, the plan involves more than that.
Okay, yes.
Yeah. I guess trigger warning about this discussion. We're not going to get too serious, but when I was rewatching this, it dawned on me what this joke was. You know, everything was leading to this one joke, and it's just like, this is a rape joke. And they built in safeguards because they were aware of it. But ultimately, it is getting a woman blackout drunk and getting her to have sex with someone against her consent. And we weren't talking about consent in 2002.
Mm-hmm.
But they realized what they were doing, and they tried to make it TV friendly. But in the end of the day, this is a rotten joke in 2022.
Yeah.
And you feel really bad for this woman.
Yeah. Yeah. In 2002, sadly, there were laws across the country, and I think there still are in some states, where like that you could give consent while drunk, which is not like that is insane. Like, no, that's it's unbelievable that was ever a law. But this episode seems to operate under that idea that Amber can consent to having sex with Abe. And also the gray area they want to shove it into is that she wanted to have sex more than he did. And then, so it's almost like Abe was abused here, in that he didn't. But when he says, I can't,
it just, it feels like they're building in these safeguards because they know the kind of joke they're making. And then when we get to the wedding video, she says, you know, you paid for the whole hour, which implies that she's a sex worker on top of that. But you know, I was thinking about it, I was like, well, no, consent went out the window when you got her blackout drunk. It doesn't matter what you paid for or whatever she agreed to while she was blackout drunk. This is a rape joke, and it's a gross way to end this episode.
And even if she had done that to Homer and Ned before, with getting them drunk, blackout drunk, and doing something, you know, that's not good revenge. You can't do it as revenge either. It's
I don't know, like, the legal definition of this, but if you go back to the episode of Viva Ned Flanders, they were all drunk during the wedding. I don't know what that implies as to who the responsible party is, but in this, clearly she was the one that was being made liquors drunk in her, and she was taken advantage of. And not to get too serious again. Sorry, Chris, we've been talking.
No. It should be talked about. I mean, this was a classic joke formula for so long, for decades before. I mean, I remember back in, this is flipping the genders a little bit, but there's this Kiefer Sutherland, Dennis Hopper movie called Flashback. And the whole joke of the beginning of it is Dennis Hopper gets Kiefer Sutherland drunk as hell and a sex worker drunk as hell, and gets them to have sex together so that he can escape, and he's on the run. And like, this was the beginning of a movie where they're like, oh yeah, like, just, it's, yeah, a little rape just to get the movie going, just to start the stuff, just a little teaser to get going. And I'm like, that's all really weird. This is all incredibly off-putting. And like, you could have literally just, it would have been bad enough if you had just gotten her drunk and put her on a bus back to Nevada. That would have been, it probably wouldn't have been funny, and it probably, you know, it would have been bad enough. But like, that they take it this far, I'm just looking at it like, oh man, yeah, definitely end this now. As soon as, you don't have to shove in the senility joke. Just get the fuck out of here.
Well, I mean, like, this is no more dirty and problematic than stuff that happened in, say, the American Pie films, for instance.
Yeah, yeah.
It was a dirty, gross, bad time.
It was bad enough. Like, I wish they would have drew the line at the marriage, not the term in the Oval Office gag.
I wish Abe didn't actually have sex with her.
Yeah,
I wish
yeah.
they could trick her into marrying Abe, but to make her have sex with him, like, it's just to make gross, like, you fucked a grandpa jokes, like, which also is such a, having sex with a senior citizen, that was also just such a, like, late 90s joke.
And this is where the RU486 joke is too. Like, she wakes up and she takes the Tylenol and the RU486, and she takes like 7 of them. It's just like fucking gross. It's just gross. Yeah.
Especially like, again, 20 years later, we're talking about reproductive rights and the show saying, hey, look at this slut and her abortion pills.
Yes. Yeah.
It's gross. It's gross. It's just like, it leaves you a bad taste in your mouth.
To see this joke now, especially as we're talking about how, like, you know, what should be easy and free to get contraceptive medication in America about to be outlawed, at least in some states, but potentially, that to see a joke from 20 years ago about, like, this is just for gross, disgusting women who are have too much sex, like, who are irresponsible, just like, it's ugh, yucko.
Yeah,
It's also just like, if Al Jean wanted to move away from the dirty stuff that happened the season before, this is the opposite of that. Like, this is dark as anything in there. But yes, let's hear the dirty joke here.
Oh, my head. Aspirin. Are you 486?
Morning, love muffin.
Who are you?
I'm your new husband, and that was a wedding night I'll never forget.
Oh, no, we didn't.
Well, we almost didn't, but you wouldn't take I can't for an answer. Want to give Honest Abe another term in the Oval Office?
No!
Oh, thank God.
So, I am shocked that they on the commentary, the one few times they can actually comment on the episode of that.
Because Delroy's off the call.
Yes. Yeah. They mentioned that originally the line was Abe train. Do you want to hop on the Abe train? Which the censor thought was too dirty. So then they said,
what was too dirty.
They said, give Abe another chance in the Oval Office, which they credit to writer Tom Martin. And they couldn't believe they got away with it. Like, come on, the Oval Office? Like, it's...
Yeah, that's so lewd.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, the last thing I'll say about this kind of joke is it's so bizarre to me that, like, it was Al Jean and people were like, yeah, he's taking the show back to its roots, back really grounding it. And this episode resolves with the family conspiring to have a woman sexually assaulted.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Strange.
And, then people were like, hooray, the show's back.
Yes.
It's still got that zing. I didn't know why we were reacting like that. Chris, sorry.
No, it's would genuinely be like, I would understand Homer going to Vegas and cheating on his wife as something that happens in a real marriage and has to be dealt with. Whereas compared to this, where they're like, it would be one thing if that was the end of it, right? Like if the end of the story was like, yes, I fooled around with her, I got married in Vegas and something happened with another woman. But the fact that it has to end in this, like, spectacularly disgusting way, like, it you just double down on the worst instincts of anything that came before this.
I think this ending would work better if Amber just, like, screamed in terror and was like, you're all monsters, and just got out of there. Like, But also it's shaky legal ground that during her wedding vows to Abe that are filmed, she renounces all other husbands, thus making Homer no longer officially her husband anymore.
I'm sure that checks out.
Yeah,
sure.
That works. Yeah. But yeah, so they, well, here's the ending. Let's just play it. Boy, this third act is rough, guys. Yeah. I'm not lying.
Our plan worked perfectly.
And we carried it out as a family.
What plan? You got me drunk.
Yeah, but this time you woke up with more than a hangover. You're married to me. Me!
I can't take it. You're too goody-goody.
Oh, that's not you talking. That's the honey mustard dressing.
Come on, Ginger. Let's go back to Vegas.
Yeah, I'm sure there's poker games we can be won in.
Ugh.
I'm so proud of us. When we stick together, we can do anything.
Oh, I lost another wife.
I'm so sorry, Grandpa.
Well, it hurts now, but the senility will take care of that. There she goes. You know, I have a son about your age. Oh, I love that.
You know, like Grandpa, I wish we could all forget about that.
Yes.
That ending.
Boy, you know, it was extra. I have to say, I laughed harder after all the stuff we just discussed than having Marge say, "I'm so proud of us." I was like, Jesus.
It's even worse that Lisa is part of this.
Yes.
Lisa.
Yeah. It's, boy.
She should walk off or just be in the corner or something. Be like, "I'm going home," or something like that.
I had no part of this, people. Like, that's what she should say. Yeah. You know what? I had given all of this cringe to the panda love scene, and that scene's no good. But boy, this is worse. This is a worse low for the family and the show and what they do.
Could this be the lowest low?
I think it might be.
I think so. I think so.
It is. Yeah.
Criminal
family.
What
a way to start. Yeah. The criminal family committing a horrific crime against a woman who trusted them to man.
I mean, that panda was just doing its job. It was not premeditated or anything.
It's a wild animal. Yeah. You can only you can sue the zoo apparently. But, yeah.
Sure.
But yeah, the first two acts have some fun stuff in it. And even the two wives, two knives things is fun. But once the two Vegas wives come in, I get that Gene had things he wanted to fix with the Vegas wives, but this was not the approach to take with fixing the Vegas wives, like not even a little bit. And to make them much grosser, disgusting women for a lot of like mean jokes about sex workers, which again, they're cocktail waitresses. It wasn't even their fucking job in their first appearances. And to then have it all end in gray, well, at best, a gray area of sexual assault. I really don't like that.
Well, they're going back to Nevada to be one in a poker game. Like, that's not even a sex worker life. That's just like, yeah, I'm worthless. I'm here to be property. Whatever. Yeah. Like, I'm not a character. Yeah.
And these characters are so despised that one of them is killed off.
That's right. Yes.
Yeah. I was just reading on the wiki. I was like, which one of these guys is dead? Which one of these ladies is dead? It's Amber, who died at a theme park in front of a sign warning people not to stand up on the roller coaster. Mm-hmm. She overdosed in front of that sign. So a very dark ending for poor Amber. These women in there, and they're just their desperate lives. I feel so bad for them.
Yeah.
Oh, they snuck a John Cassavetes movie into this show. Like, Amber's life is just like absolutely rock as hell, and like you just see it in brief glimpses as the from the tormentor point of view.
But you know what? I do chuckle at honey mustard dressing being a drug in Ned's house, that he views it as like, you know, that's too spicy, honey mustard dressing. But
well, it's not the unflavored ice milk. And oh, even more tragic, Ginger did not attend Amber's funeral.
Oh, come on, man. I feel like the current animators would draw her in there. They would remember to do that. They put in lots of good. I just saw a Bang Bang Bart reference used correctly of Homer, Bart's future stripper persona. Hmm. But yeah, I mean, this episode is also, as we're talking about this, you just forget about Gabriel or all the environmental stuff. Like, it's so far away. Like, this is such a weird ass episode.
It's an inauspicious beginning to Al Jean's first season back. There are better episodes after this, folks. Don't worry.
Yes.
This is just a very, very low point and unfortunate choices that were rooted in the context of where humor was at the time. So. Yes.
Absolutely. Bad year, bad episode.
Exactly. But yeah, I guess I have nothing more to say.
I guess that's it. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Bad really year, bad episode. Nothing good can come out of the year 2002. Nothing at all. I'm sorry if you were born then, but you're wrong. You're a demon child. You should be wiped from the earth. But Chris, thanks for being on the show. You're on We Hate Movies, of course. You've got all kinds of stuff happening. We Hate Movies. You've got the Patreon with the Melrose 210 show I talked about. Also, a Gleep Glossary. I assume you'll be covering the whatever Star Wars show comes out. Henry would know about this.
Obi-Wan?
There you go.
Obi-Wan. We'll be doing that very soon, yes. God damn.
Can you give us a preview of what's happening in the month of June when this podcast goes live?
Oh, well, in June, I mean, we're going to be, I think we'll be back. We're going to have another once in a lifetime episode. I'm not sure if we're going to do another one of our Stalked by Our Doctors, but we might have to go back for thirds. And then we're going to be doing a We Love Movies. We haven't actually decided. We've been doing more of like, we want to decide closer to the actual release date to do a We Love Movies, but we have a big one planned, I will say. And then, of course, as Bob said, we will be doing another Melrose 210. A lot of summer, I mean, it's going to be the summer blockbuster extravaganza on the show during the summer, just on our live feed on iTunes and wherever you get your podcasts for our weekly episodes that are free. But then, yeah, patreon.com/wehatemovies. The boys have been on the show for the Simpsons movie, which is funny you mentioned that. The beginning of this episode did really feel like a rough draft of where they were going to start that movie. It is funny that it ended up like that. But yeah, thanks for having me on again, guys. This is always a lot of fun.
No, it's awesome to have you on. Thank you so
much,
Chris.
Thanks again to Chris Cavan for being on the show. Please check out We Hate Movies. We love everything they do over there. As for us, if you want to check out more of what we do and get all these episodes 1 week at a time and ad-free, please head on over to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Head on over there for $5 a month to get just that, but also access to everything behind the $5 paywall. That includes over 100 miniseries episodes. They're full length about cartoons you love. And also on that tier, there is regular access to episodes of both Talking Futurama and Talk King of the Hill, our monthly regular miniseries. Only behind the $5 paywall, only at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, and there is a $10 level as well. Sign up for that, you get all the $5 stuff, of course, but also access to one Megalon podcast once a month, only for patrons of that level or higher. And what is that, Henry?
Bob is talking about the What, a Cartoon Movie podcast, where me and Bob go super deep into an animated feature film once a month, just like we do on The Simpsons. And that means if we're going with a film like Who Framed Roger Rabbit, we talk for 6.5 hours on it. When we did Toy Story 3, 6 whole hours on that one. And a giant back catalog, I would say over 260 hours of us covering animated feature films. Upcoming it this month, we're going to be doing The Little Mermaid. And previous ones have included South Park Bigger, Longer, and Uncut, Kiki's Delivery Service, Akira, and A Goofy Movie. Check it all out at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
And as for me, I've been one of your hosts, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo, and my other podcast is Retronauts. That's a classic gaming podcast all about old video games. Find out more about that wherever you find podcasts, or go to patreon.com/retronauts to sign up there for 2 full-length bonus episodes every month. Henry, how about you?
You can follow me on Twitter at HENEREYG. Stay in the loop on all the cool stuff going on in my life. And if you were following me and Bob on Twitter, then you absolutely have to follow at TalkSimpsonsPod on Twitter. Stay in the loop whenever new podcasts go live on the free feed, on the Patreon, when there's polls, when there's other news going on in our lives. At TalkSimpsonsPod will keep you up to date. And if you want to find an easy-to-search back catalog of all the free podcasts we have put out on Talking Simpsons and What a Cartoon, head over to TalkingSimpsonsPodcast.com.
Thanks so much for listening, folks. We'll see you again next time for Season 3's Treehouse of Horror 2, and we'll see you then.
A grizzly bear with a chainsaw. Now there's a killing machine.